American president boldly proclaimed a respect of liberty and the freedoms expressed in the Constitution of the United States.
We should give particular attention to the needs of those countries which share our view of the world crisis. Our view of the world crisis is that countries are entitled to national sovereignty and independence. That is all we have ever suggested. That is the purpose of our aid, to make it more possible. Now, if a country has ceased to choose national sovereignty or ceased to choose a national independence, then, of course, our aid becomes less useful.
Well, take a look at who is steering the ship today. The New World Order Panderer-in-Chief, President Obama, was recently in Vietnam hyping the prospect of slashing tariffs on products imported into the United States, aggressively pushing a multinational corporation sovereign-killing trade deal linking 40% of the global economy into a full-blown smackdown on the already struggling U.S. economy. The LA Times writes, ordinarily a presidential administration would wait until Congress ratifies a trade agreement before putting it into force with member nations. But with just 8 months left in office and presidential candidates Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump, and Bernie Sanders all against the deal, Obama and his advisors appear to have concluded that they must speed up that lengthy process to preserve the trade pact. This president of ours is blatantly taking this country down and spreading his belly full of total loathing for America across the globe. This is the same president that signed the NDAA in the middle of the night after threatening to veto it, a document guaranteeing that American citizens can be disappeared by the authorities without any explanation, much less their rights.
These people are saying that the passing of the bill, basically it means to them that the Rubicon has been crossed, that this means America will become complete and possibly irreversible a totalitarian military state.
Well, then our only hope is some defective armed force members.
I think that's our only chance, is the military needs to enforce our Constitution, and our congressmen are trampling over the rules that were established over 200 years ago. And that's the whole problem. There's too much corruption in the executive branch and in the congressional.
The same president behind a draft to install a government official into each home to oversee your children. The document states, the first step in systematically embedding effective family engagement practices in educational settings is to establish a culture where families are seen as assets and partners in children's development. The same president that lied his tail off to get into office in order to enact globalist New World Order directives while simultaneously rewarding the corporate demons running the central banks with toppled regimes and more central banks. Obama is the first president in U.S. history to not see a single year of 3% GDP growth. That is who was apologizing to Japan and Vietnam for the rhetoric of Donald Trump.
They're rattled by it, and for good reason, because a lot of the proposals that he's made display either ignorance of world affairs or a cavalier attitude or an interest in getting tweets and headlines instead of actually thinking through what it is that is required to keep America safe and secure and prosperous.
If they're rattled in a friendly way, we're going to have great relationships with these countries. He's a president who's done a horrible job. Everybody understands that. He's a president who's allowed many of these countries to totally take advantage of him and us, unfortunately. And he's got to say something. And it's unusual that every time he has a press conference, he's talking about me.
Say what you want about Trump.
The majority group who support Trump are white families with a lot of money.
Albeit, you are an absolute fool if you can't stomach the facts and realize that Obama is 1,000 times worse. In years to come, if the United States is still here, we will be adamantly apologizing for electing President Barack Obama to 2 terms.
In America, there's a failure to appreciate Europe's leading role in the world. Instead of celebrating your dynamic union and seeking to partner with you to meet common challenges, there have been times where America's shown arrogance and been dismissive.
John Bound for Infowars.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, when we get back, we're launching this Friday transmission. Ladies and gentlemen, it is Friday, the 27th day of May 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We'll be here for the next 4 hours today. Jakari Jackson just got back from several days on the West Coast, but also in New Mexico, experiencing the anti-Trump, anti-free speech riots. He got hit with a rock. He got tear gas previous to that in Ferguson. They got smoke bombed also out in California. He's going to be popping in at the bottom of the hour while Ben Garrison, the famous, extremely famous, he's one of the top political cartoonists in the last century, really, syndicated around the country. They've been trying to censor him as of late, saying he's racist for criticizing Barack Obama. And, of course, he did a cartoon last week showing the first lady, the first tranny, according to Joan Rivers, Michelle Obama, looking like a man versus the new first lady that's coming down the road, hopefully. That's Donald Trump's wife. Political cartoons have always made fun of how people look and exacerbated flaws. I mean, I've been made to look like everything you can imagine in political cartoons. In fact, they've done many political cartoons for whatever reason where I'm a woman, whatever. You know, this is all just part of political satire, but they're trying to act like that's illegal, that's wrong, that can't be done. And that ties into an article out of Germany. Fines for online speech can run into the thousands of euros. It's happening. Arrest. Fines. They're reactivating Stasi operatives. You cannot make this up. And this is what they want to sell and push here in the United States. And then, of course, David Knight's going to be honchoing the fourth hour today. Now, I want to get into campaign 2016. I want to get into the so-called recovery, which they admit is a fraud. We are also going to be looking at what's happening outside of our world that affects what's happening on our planet, because we kind of get this idea that, well, we live here in America, so the rest of the world doesn't exist. Or we live here on the planet, so the rest of the universe doesn't exist. The truth is, most science that is seen as settled, whether it was 500 years ago or 50 years ago, turns out to be wrong or partially wrong as we learn more. An example of that is people used to think the world was flat. Now we could see the sun and other planets turning with telescopes and know that they are indeed spherical. And we understand a lot more about the sun and the mathematics of how it operates as a giant thermonuclear furnace. But we also were told that we weren't hit by large asteroids, but every few million years. Now that we have satellites, we can see all the big craters on the planet that have just been filled in by trees and grass or oceans or seas or lakes. I don't know how old the world is. And from a scientific perspective, we can't document exactly where human life came from. Those are the mysteries of the universe, or what created the universe, what created reality. You can always say, well, God did. Well, then what came before God? I guess God. It's that age-old question. But I know this. There is a bizarre arrogance by the power elite, as they call themselves, by the parasites, where 6 years ago at the UN, at the Copenhagen summit, there were all these scientists there saying, look, it's the sun that drives climate. And the sun goes in 12-year cycles, and then in larger, it looks like 120-year cycles, and then it's got 1,000-year cycles, because the ancients marked all this down very, very clearly. And then we've done studies the last few hundred years, scientists have. The sun is one of the most studied objects, obviously, in the universe. It's very close to us. It's very visible. It's very easy to study. Our life is based on it. Almost completely, without the sun, we'd be dead in a matter of hours. So the UN voted, you can actually pull this article up, UN votes to say that the sun does not affect climate change, that it's all humans, so that they can tax us and say that we are the problem when there's a tornado or a hurricane or a snowstorm or a dust storm or a firestorm or whatever the case may be. It's like the Vatican 500 years ago saying that the Earth was the center of the universe and that the sun and other planets orbited the Earth. And 100 years before that, they were locking up Copernicus and, you know, Galileo, and people are trying to, because they said the Earth was round. Spherical. But now there is new video out, shot by NASA, and this was also observed by amateur astronomers, and there is new photos out that show the sun imploding, basically sputtering, like your engine cutting out for a moment, because it is the continued controlled thermonuclear explosion of the hydrogen and other gases. You can just go to the encyclopedia if you want and, you know, read about how the sun operates. In fact, guys, I'm no physicist. I know the basics. I'm no astrophysicist. But you guys just print me an encyclopedia breakdown on how the sun operates so I get this exactly right. The point is, most people don't even know anything about the sun or care when it's the most important things physically in our lives. When it has a mass coronal ejection, it sometimes shoots out molten plasma and light energy hundreds of millions of miles, and if it ever actually was pointed directly at the Earth, would fry the Earth. Some of these coronal ejections are so big, not just radiation, not just light, you know, that blasts satellites and communications, but so much heat it would actually burn off our atmosphere. That's what it's shooting out into space. That's how powerful it is. So before I get into all the worldly news, let's talk about what's really going on. It'd be like if you had a magnifying glass in your backyard looking at an ant and you thought that was the whole universe. And then you stood up and looked around you and you were in the middle of a big city with skyscrapers around you and you were in a little grass lot, you know, in the back of a Chinese food restaurant. It's the same thing. The public just focuses in, and the globalists want us to focus in on a few grains of sand and a few pieces of grass and an ant, maybe a doodle bug or something crawling by. Well, here's the article in the Daily Express. Is the sun disintegrating? You are free to use any means necessary, but I want them alive. No disintegrations. NASA spots monster hole open up on our star, and it's our star. I don't worship the sun, but if I was a pagan, that's what I'd worship. It warms us. It gives us life. It the plants grow. It's just everything physical. You got to have light, water, carbon dioxide, and oxygen. Without that, you're dead. We're carbon-based life forms, and it's the sun, and I love it. I love the sun. All the ancients loved it. It's common sense. It's good. And the average person's knowledge on the sun is just almost zero. So it's a huge explosion going on of compact gas on fire, but its gravity so big it sucks that in a controlled explosion, and at the edges of its gravity it forms the event horizon or the edge of the sun. But then explosions inside cause huge eruptions coming out from it. Mass coronal ejections. You're a TV viewer, I've got NASA HD footage of the sun behind us. And man, this new footage and these new photos show it looks like a good 20-30% of the sun implodes in and goes what looks like dark matter, where the light's not even escaping. It goes dark red, which means it's not even as hot as the white hot. And the scientists are saying it looks like it was losing its combustion. It was losing its stability. And folks, when suns start to do this, they either shrivel up and form red dwarfs, white dwarfs, black dwarfs, depending on what type of sun they were. And then a lot of times those end up imploding. You have a nova and it explodes, or a supernova and the whole solar system goes goodbye. There's lots of different variants of this. But let me tell you, when you're sitting there looking at the sun and the whole top implodes in, like a top of Kennedy's head blowing off, and it all turns black and you see there's nothing there, and it's not the sun in there, big piece of the sun just disappears. All right, coming up in the next segment, I'm going to play a bunch of Trump clips. Getting to him and the supposed Bernie Sanders debate that's coming up. The latest on the Hillary scandal with the inspector general from the State Department saying, no, she clearly broke the law. She's clearly lied. I mean, she's done. If she doesn't get indicted, This is one of the most flagrant examples of someone being caught red-handed committing crime and not getting in trouble. But all that aside, our son is a AG type main sequence star, G2V based on spectral class, and is informally referred to as a yellow dwarf. It's a little star. It formerly, approximately 4.6 billion years ago, they think, from the gravitational collapse of matter within a region of the large molecular cloud. Most of this matter gathered in the center, whereas the rest flattened into an orbital disk that became a solar system. The central mass became increasingly hot and dense, eventually intergalactic fusion in its core. Or INTA, can't pronounce this, nuclear fusion at its core. And then it just goes on to how they think it's operating. The point is, you can go study the sun. It's very interesting, obviously. Sunspots, magnetic field, neutrinos, its atmosphere, how it's operating, the different levels of the sun. But here's the bottom line from a layperson, and this is what the scientists are saying in the news articles. When you see the surface of the sun collapse in 30, 40% deep, that means the core is sputtering and collapsing further, and it's losing stability. And from just a lay researcher, but I was checking it, and they say this, it's never been seen a collapse of this level. So let me tell you, your insurance policy isn't going to cover this if the sun collapses. And I know you know that, but the TSA can't keep you safe with a checkpoint from the sun collapsing. And it just shows the elite are not God. And they can try to pass laws where the UN says the sun does not affect climate. It is total and complete malarkey. But I suggest folks just go research the corona. That's just the hot area around the sun, the flares, the prominence, the chromosphere, the photosphere. And as you go beneath the surface into the different areas in the core, it's just absolutely spectacular. And then out from that, you've got the solar wind. And that's what knocks out satellites and things like that and comes through the atmosphere and forms nuclei that allows water droplets to form. I mean, the sun just dominates Earth. It dominates basically all activity on Earth other than volcanic activity that is heat trapped, of course, in our core and that stays hot because of gravitational pressures. That is the only other heat source on this planet that's measurable to any degree. Is volcanic activity, tectonic activity. The pressures. And it's believed that some life could still operate in the deep sea, or if the sun blew and we had time to know it was about to blow or collapse, that they could have limited numbers of people go below the Earth and try to set up thermal civilizations, at least for a time, until we built spacecraft to get out of the dead solar system. But obviously, we don't have anything near that technology now or the commitment to work together to have something like that. And I'm just, again, as a layperson here who's done cursory studying of this, marveling at it. I mean, I'm not trying to scare people and saying the sun's collapsing. That'll probably be on MSNBC by tonight. I'm simply pointing out this is how tenuous things are on this planet. Whether it's asteroids or comets or pole shifts, or mega earthquakes, every ancient civilization said that they went through giant cataclysms on a routine basis. But scientists today tell us, oh, no, it only happens every few million years. But all the data is saying that's not true. Like in the case of the comet that hit one of the gas giants, Shoemaker-Levy. They had to say, okay, we think every few thousand years a big asteroid hits. Every 100,000 years a giant one. Now they're saying, okay, maybe sooner than that. Because they're able to watch them with radio telescopes come by on a routine basis with near misses, asteroids that would cause a dinosaur level extinction event on terra firma. So I don't care about red carpets and acting cool and trendiness, because I can walk out and look at the sun every day or the moon or the Horsehead Nebula through my telescope in my backyard. There's just so much incredible stuff around us. And the fact that a NASA spokesman said Coronal holes are low-density regions of the sun's atmosphere known as the corona, and we've just seen a major collapse in the corona, giving us a view deeper into the sun. Pretty scary stuff. Globalist social engineers love to say that perception is reality. And yeah, if somebody's on PCP or LSD, if they're taking enough of it, they think they can jump off a 100-story building and fly, they may believe they're actually flying till gravity sets in when they hit the bottom and turn into a pulverized mess for the fire department to clean up. And what I try to do here is just to get people to think outside the box. I know that's a cliched statement, but that's really what we're trying to do. And just look at history and then look at what's currently happening and then look at where we're going, where our trajectory is headed, and it isn't pretty. And I've been charting that trajectory for 21 years on air, and folks that have been longtime listeners have pointed out, wow, this guy knows what he's talking about, on average. And you can go back to shows I did 20 years ago or 15 years ago, to films I made 19 years ago, 5 years ago, 8 years ago, and you watch them, and it's like, wow, all that ended up happening. Wow, this guy really had a handle on things. Well, let me take away some credit from myself. The globalist social engineers have written hundreds of books and thousands of white papers admitting everything they plan to do. And let me tell you what's scary. They've gotten close to 90% done of what they want. Now, they wanted to have most of this done, world government openly in place by 2000, and then have a lot of their program in place by 2016, 2017. They're about 16, 17 years behind. They're trying to accelerate things right now and get it all done. And they're getting a lot of it done, but it's really revealing it to people. So they're just upping the propaganda, upping the disinfo, upping the smoke screens, the infighting, the balkanization. And I don't think it's going too well for them, but I'll tell you what's scary. They don't seem to care. They're committed. They're going ahead with it. Now, I want to play a bunch of Trump clips, and I mentioned this yesterday, so I actually want to play it today because it is a big deal. Katie Couric got caught with this big documentary, this anti-gun documentary, and we've written articles about it for a few days. We've done reports on it. The Nightly News has. Shock video, Katie Couric edited gun documentary to silence pro-gun groups, and folks were inside and able to record what really happened. People are getting smart because they do this trick. They've got a bunch of tricks. They've done it to me where they'll ask you a question, you'll answer it, and then they'll just say, we need to just shoot some footage and get some room noise right now. Which is true. So in case they edit things, they have, you know, the room noise so you don't hear pops and hisses, you know, in the broadcast. Or they'll put an image over you and do a jump cut and cut from not what you were saying to an answer, but to some other answer to make you look like a crazy person. Or sometimes they just take like an hour of what I've said and edit it together frame by frame where I'm saying the wildest stuff you could ever imagine. And it's even obvious it's been heavily edited. But they don't care. They think their viewers are that stupid or aren't paying attention. I mean, it's wild. Or even your conscious mind knows you just saw a dirty edit, a deceptive spliced edit. But your subconscious still comes off with the fact that I'm saying I want to kill black people or I hate women or I want to murder children. Because they'll take where I've said that and edit it together. You've seen it on the national news. You've seen it online. And you ask yourself, what's the tactic? Because they won't say this is satire or this is a joke. We've taken videos of Obama and edited them before to make him say wild things a few times, but said this is a joke. So what are they getting at? I mean, do they know what they're doing, or are they arrogant? Well, I think with a 6% trust rate in the national media and national polls, probably lower than that, I think it's failed. So you got to ask yourself, are they smoking their own dope? Is the establishment and their minions, their propagandists, their disinformation agents, their pitchmen, are they the only ones that are believing the bull anymore? Is another question. But there's such an important article I ran in today, because I scan the news at night and the morning and, you know, do some of my own research, obviously, but the crew gives me hundreds of articles a day and dozens of video clips to go over. And one really caught my eye and really clicked. And I had an original thought in the paradigm of the globalist model that connected so many dots. And I'm learning new stuff all the time, but this was game-changing. And I've been told the founder of the Pirate Bay is a listener and that we should be able to get him on. So I want to have that happen. But this is just an incredible, incredible, incredible statement when it comes to understanding what globalism is. It's not Star Trek. It's not everybody kumbaya under the UN symbol out there fighting, you know, evil 7-foot lizards. And it's not what Zeitgeist pushes. It's a nightmare, according to their own admissions. But this was such a realization when I saw this. I mean, I knew this. I've talked about this forever. You knew this. But there's that moment when it just crystallizes and you totally get it. In fact, it's in the Darren McBreen promo piece that we did. It's like 7 minutes long on Network. But you can probably find the piece online. The corporate board scene where Howard Beale is in there with the head of the multinational conglomerate. And he says, "You have meddled with the tidal forces of nature, Mr. Beale, and you will atone. You think you've only simply stopped a merger, Mr. Beale." And then he goes into how globalism works. 1970s film, in your face. Robert Duvall is so good in that movie. "We got a hit. We got a big hit." Wish I could quote it fully. But when I read this article, it was just like, wow. Absolutely. I see what they're doing. And then these power players come together and weld the system all into one piece. And you can really see they're doing it. And if they just had goodwill for humanity, I would be behind global government. As long as nation states and people opted in, could get out when they wanted to, there wasn't a central world government army, you know, a lot of things like that. That's what you don't want. But yeah, a 1776 global republic of states, that's how you do stop war. But see, they have all these great ideas of why they want world government, but then they're the ones like Loki running around stirring up the crises to bring in more control. And when they get more control, they even cause more crisis and attack the Earth. John Bowne has an excellent report up on Infowars.com. New World Order destroys the Earth and you get the bill. They're the ones destroying it, and then they set up a system to bill you for it and to give themselves more power. But I'm going to cover this article in just a moment. Here it is. It's CNBC. Arjun Karpal is the article. I want to post this on Infowars.com, folks. Mark Zuckerberg is director of Facebook Nation, the Pirate Bay founder said. Now, again, folks, when I say director, I'm being sarcastic because the real headline is Mark Zuckerberg is dictator of Facebook Nation, the Pirate Bay founder said. Now, think about this. They don't call it global government. They call it global governance. They don't call it dictatorship. They call it centralized directive technocracy. Centralized directive technocracy is the word they've been using for about 6 years in popular parlance at Davos, Switzerland meetings that are the highest level public regurgitation of what Club of Rome, Bilderberg, Council on Foreign Relations, all the same people, all the same roundtable groups were organizing and pushing to the media and to their fellow travelers at the next level down the pyramid or the next circle out from a centralized system. Mark Zuckerberg. So I make the point, Mark Zuckerberg is director of Facebook Nation, the Pirate Bay founder. And I use that term to remind you that they normally call themselves directors. But he is dictatorial and setting up a dictatorial system, and that's what the Pirate Bay is saying, and that's exactly what this is. But Zuckerberg himself is nothing but an intelligence agency frontman to be the public face, to be the president, basically, of the military-industrial complex and the big banking cartel that created Facebook, that financed Facebook, and that has allowed it through the courts and systems central control. Here are the four big groups: Apple, Google, Facebook, And then, of course, you've got Twitter, but that's a subgroup, and then IBM, and you could say five. But I don't think Twitter is that central. And again, these are all spinoffs of a technocracy plan launched by IBM and Thomas Watson and the Cold Spring Harbor Initiative more than 100 years ago in New York, then beta tested in New York City with Margaret Sanger and the Rockefeller Foundation. And they are creating a system that becomes the internet, where they put regulations and controls in and taxes and end internet net neutrality everywhere else, where they force you onto Apple, Google, Facebook, Twitter platforms. IBM runs a lot of the infrastructure, or was the original core progenitor, but now is just really a name. And it's the robber baron industrial class, military industrial class, big pharma class, scientific invasion force, just like they were aliens from Mars in War of the Worlds studying us like a scientist would study microbes in a petri dish, to quote the beginning of War of the Worlds. Think about how epic that is. And then they create a nation within nations within the world. See, globalism always creates master regions and then breaks down the original sovereign systems and then dissolves that into sub-directives that are balkanized but owe fealty to the larger centralized system itself, just another managing board of the other two, the trifecta. Three global regions with sub-regions, 10 sub-regions with 10 sub-regions within those regions. Three global regions broken into 10 regions, three regions in each with one super governing region, the 10th, then with 10 regions per three regions. It's almost like Lord of the Rings. Here, have these nine rings. Here, have these other rings. Oh, I didn't tell you about this ring. Zuckerberg, you know, gets everybody's little meeting. Oh, you'll be the good conservatives that kiss my ring, and you'll be allowed to operate for a while. Here's your free rings. But I have this one. But of course, they know full well he's got the ring. But the truth is, Facebook itself isn't the one ring. It's only a part of the one ring. That's how they deceive all these people. It's amazing. And my dad, again, in Plan 2 in the mid-1960s in high school, was already going to the University of Texas out of high school in the summers. And they told him all this. They were like, here's CD-ROM, and we're going to have a technocracy, and we're going to, you know, breed people to be more advanced, and we're going to create this one-world government. That was all mainline back then. And then folks would warn about it, and they'd have the national news go, the John Birch Society is completely insane. None of that's going on, even though it was in all these different textbooks and white papers. So you read this article, it is so incredibly profound because it just throws it in your face that that's really what it is. These mega global corporate nations, how do you get people to join a global government? Here's the profound thought. How do you get people to join a global government when there's not a culture, there's not a nation state? It's just some guy from Harvard who suddenly took over a third of the internet and calls his users dumb effers and spies on everyone. And it's connected to agencies and the government, but that's okay because your culture is Facebook. Your family's there. Your job's there. Where you eat's there. Your life is there. That's your nation. That's your tribe led by a predator who's a front man for super predators who calls you dumb and who censors people around the world and helps the communist Chinese censor en masse. That's how global government has its nations, is its cyber nations. And China has its own cyber nation now. And they've said, we're going to have a behavioral score in the real world, but also in the cyber world, all fed back digitally. And if you do anything anti-government or anti-Facebook or anti-establishment, or even speak out against us, or even don't do exactly what we want, we will downgrade you to a point where you can't get credit and can't operate and can't live and can't even have a website on the internet, period, or on Facebook. Coming to America, China introduces credit score for obedient citizens social isolation for people who express controversial opinions or dissent. What did Matt Drudge say before that article ever came out, before they announced that? He said, these are internet ghettos where they dehumanize you. And he's the president, unelected. He builds it with the government, with NQTEL, with the CIA. They're allowed to do things nobody else is allowed to do. Everybody else will be sued out of existence. The regulators are hands off. The antitrust groups are hands off. The government lets them spy, do illegal things, hands off. China lets them in because it's part of the takeover. And then your president, your dictator, is Mark Zuckerberg, who goes to Bilderberg and who does big pump and dump schemes on the internet. And who decides who gets to be seen and who gets to heard and what restaurant gets to have visitors and what restaurant doesn't. Total control over everything if we don't realize it and say something about it and do something about it. And the good news is people are. Even mainstream news says Facebook is, quote, eating the internet. Mark Zuckerberg is director of Facebook. Again, I use that term because they normally dial that back. But this time they're being honest. Mark Zuckerberg, it actually says, is dictator of Facebook Nation, the Pirate Bay founder says. Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg is the dictator of the biggest nation in the world. It's got billions of people. The co-founder of the file-sharing site Pirate Bay told CNBC on Friday as he denounced the centralization of power on the internet. Speaking during an interview with the Next Web Conference in Amsterdam, Peter Sund said that there is no democracy online. People in the tech industry have a lot of responsibilities, but they never really discuss those things. Facebook is the biggest nation in the world. We have a dictator. If you look at it from the democracy standpoint, Mark Zuckerberg is a dictator. I did not elect him. He sets the rules, he told CNBC. And you really can't opt out of Facebook. I'm not on Facebook, but there are a lot of drawbacks in my offline world. No party invitations, no updates from friends. People stop talking to you because you're not on Facebook. So it has real life implications. Yeah. And here's the bigger deal. It's spying on you and manipulating you and taking you out of Facebook if you don't comply and then acting like it's not a social engineering, social control grid. I'm going to skip this network break. Because there will be no future, there will be no radio, there will be no independent systems if they have their way, because they're going to let Facebook, YouTube, which is Google, Apple systems, and a few others, along with communist China and governments working with them and meeting with Facebook and Apple and others. I mean, Apple makes its slave goods there with suicide nets. That's what they think of humans. They'll do that to them. They'll do that to you. And while you're busy worried about tranny bathrooms and all these faux rights, all of our basic rights are being taken. That's the smokescreen. This man's a dog. A fire hydrant must be provided for him. You know, this is where it's going. The state must pay to dump Drano in this woman's eyes because her identity is she's blind. Meanwhile, we're competing against China that has billions of slaves, a billion plus slaves. You understand where this is going? These are hardcore people who funded the Arab Spring to overthrow more truly progressive governments and install hardcore jihadist Wahhabist garbage. They mean business. Our so-called CIA is openly run by multinational robber barons that have overthrown every country they can, leftist, right-wing, populist, they don't care, to install robber barons to rob everyone and make everyone poor. They want you poor. They want you dumb. They want you stupid. That's why I started the broadcast saying, there's a big club and we ain't in it, playing the famous clips of George Carlin. Talk about a prophet. And by the way, every time I say somebody's behaving like a prophet, I don't mean they're a literal biblical prophet. I said yesterday in a video that in the people's message to Donald Trump, you have entered the historical sector or the archetype of a deliverer or a prophet like Moses, taking us out of bondage. I didn't literally mean he was Moses. But see, we're so concerned about words, and most people don't even get the meanings of words or the subtle nuances of language. Just as George Orwell said, the Fabian Socialist plan that he was part of was to reduce language where you couldn't even communicate with people, and there'll be that final generation that has enough of a palette of ideas and words and symbols and ideas that they could ever communicate or resurrect civilization, and once they're gone, it's all over, except for the technocrats walled off in their high-tech system. They will have all that advanced systems, but we won't. You're like, well, that'll be okay. We'll just be dumb savages. No, we're being reduced down to blibbering idiots so that we are profane, and so it's not a spiritual sin to kill us because we will be animals. And then karmically, the elite will not take on the burden of exterminating us. It is metaphysical. It is a cult. I don't follow it. They do. I understand it. There's some truth there, but the way they do it, it's very weird. I just go with God, go with my gut, go with my center. Well, I see what they're doing. It's very twisted. I don't read it all, but man, they're doing some really bad stuff, folks. And they need you to give up and decide you're an animal. Give up and decide you don't have free will. Give up and start hating everybody around you. Give up and be mean to those that are stupider than you right under you so that metaphysically you can then be preyed upon. Don't prey on people. It opens the door spiritually to get jacked over. Do you understand that? But evil people just don't get it. And fallen people just don't get it. And I'm fallen too, but I mean really fallen. I mean, you like being fallen. I'm fallen and I know it, and I want to get resurrected. I want my spirit uploaded to the real God, and I don't want to hang around with these people. I want to go to the next level. Call it the heavens, whatever you want. Yeah, take me to the mothership. And I don't mean that in a literal sense. You know what I mean. I don't want to sit here and prey on my own species and rule over a bunch of idiots. And everyone's into being victims, and everyone's into being slighted, and everyone's into just fantasy land. And that's the knowledge of evil, not the knowledge of good. And so it is very, very transcendent to understand that they are building a total, complete counterfeit. And you wonder, why is the mainstream media and Facebook culture and Google culture promoting Mao Zedong and stuff so alien, so ugly, so weird? Why do movie theaters in Austin say they want women to pee standing up? That sounds stupid. No, they're being led into the guild as social engineers. They know they're part of it. They know they're following something bigger to end us as a species. They believe if they help end us as a species, that will give them entree to the elite. No, betraying your own species and everything that's good about us will not give you entrance. The elite aren't getting entrance. And by the way, it's not some magical grass is greener, cross the troll bridge, get Valhalla. It's already here. We've been given by the Creator everything we need to build anything we want and do anything we want. Anything! The things we can do today were unimaginable 1,000 years ago. Unimaginable. The things we will do in 100 years, if we survive this, will be unimaginable. You will not be able to conceive them. What we do after that will be unconceivable to those a year before. And what we do a second after that will be unconceivable to everything that was ever done before. We're entering the unconceivable. Where did the universe come from? Where did it end? Where does it begin? You will know all of that. And then you won't want to screw people over anymore. Once you've been in the presence of God. That's why they tell you there's no God while they fight to act like they're God and say they're God every millisecond because they know there's a God. But they are on such twisted power trips that they want to be gods themselves. When you were made by God in the image of God, hiding in plain view, you don't even get the riddle that a 2-year-old could figure out. And that's because you're fallen. And you're like your adopted father, the devil, who loves death. And all those that hate me, Christ said, love death. And you love it. Briefly, as I skipped that break, support us, buy the products. X2 sale ends in a few days. I'm going to have to end it Sunday because it is selling out and we won't get any more in for almost a month. It's the good halogen. If you don't get it, I think you're nuts. The bad halogens are bombarding us. We're under chemical attack. It's on record. This can't reverse a lot of the damage, but it can stop, in my view and research, more of the damage happening. It's a game changer, and it gets so much of stuff out of your body. It's $23, normally $29. It's the most powerful true iodine out there. It's true atomic iodine out of the earth, totally clean. It is the real deal. It's what God gave us. It's what we operate off of. We die without it. It's why they've done everything they can to starve us of it. They've got all these five-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. If you only buy one product, this is it. I cannot emphasize this enough. It's so important for people to take it. Patrick, from an undisclosed location, five-star review. I put my entire family on iodine. Everyone loves it and notices the difference. AC from Springfield, MA. Thank you. Five stars. Daily use. InfoWarsLife.com. I love their specials at InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. And Supermel Vitality is back in. We need fuel to load the engines in another bombing run. Buy the product. Second hour coming up. We're getting into the whole situation with the Trump clips and more. I tend to go off on 20, 30-minute jags like I did last hour. On stories like Mark Zuckerberg is dictator of Facebook Nation, the Pirate Bay founder, says CNBC. That's what this is. These are global corporate dictators who will run the AI computer systems and do that govern the planet and that manipulate reality. And people fall on their knees and go, oh, be nice to me. I'll worship you. That'll only be a season till it gets full control. Because it is a eugenics-built AI system to build the next level and not have organic growth of the species, but let the, quote, elite technocrats take control of human development. And they've told us humans are obsolete and ugly and bad. We're going to get rid of ourselves and merge with machines. And I'm like, whoa, whoa there, big boy, here on Spaceship Earth. You didn't really talk to the public about that. Well, the public's dumbed down and evil. Watch an NFL. You did that, and you wrote textbooks bragging about it in a 70-year program. I don't think that's very nice. Plus, a lot of us aren't dumbed down, and we know what you're doing. Stop it. And they just go, start the demonization campaign. Patriots and gun owners and Christians are evil. Those that are against transhumanism are backwards and must be exterminated. You know, it's like, whoa. I saw a bumper sticker, not a bumper sticker, a car yesterday that had a bumper sticker on it. And it was of a man and a woman and then a Dalek from Doctor Who that rolls around going, exterminate, exterminate, exterminate. And I thought, wow, is this a eugenicist driving this car? Because that, or just someone with a good sense of humor. Because a Dalek about to kill a man and a woman. People put in their car, hey, I'm a mom, hey, I'm a dad, we got three kids, we have a dog, here's our family, it's our tribe, isn't it cute? This person's like, yeah, I'm a Dalek aiming a weapon at a man and woman about to kill him. In fact, guys, it's on my phone. If you want, Nico, you can pull it off and actually tweet it. I mean, I'm not saying this person's a bad person. You know, we ought to, legally, we can try to run this person's plate. I guess you gotta, I don't know how you do that. And, like, contact them and see why they have a Dalek on the back of their car, you know, about to kill a man and a woman. And just ask, what's the whole point? You know, what do you mean by this? Here you go, Nico. I'll show it to you. You can run on in here. You know, I can actually just have a document cam on this. Let me pull this up, and I'll actually just show TV viewers. But then I do want to tweet this out. It's here in my camera roll. It was yesterday. Or was that a couple days ago? I'm going to find it. Here it is. Yeah, it's kind of blurred because it was raining. Okay, I'm going to cover the person's license plate up. But here it is. Here's their car, and here's the Dalek. Document cam that. So you've got the Dalek about to exterminate the people. He's got weapons up. And I guess this guy or this lady didn't have much luck, I guess, in relationships. Kind of feels down about the world. So just kind of wants to see the whole world burn. Maybe that's what they mean by this. I mean, I'm not sure. Drive around in their Ford truck, Ford SUV. Oh, and I guess they already found online. Folks have images of Daleks exterminating the family. I guess this is a popular deal. A lot of folks want to exterminate Christians, I see. Oh, I get it. Yeah, I figured. It's all part of the spirit of the age. But, of course, these people aren't committing suicide. They want to live. They just want to see you go bye-bye. All right, we're going to come back and talk to Ben Garrison, who is a very, very popular political cartoonist who's been persecuted as of late. And then we might have Tim Kennedy pop in today. He's here at the office. But I thought, why not just get Tim on? I'm going to talk to him right now. He's riding shotgun with us as we cover news. and the intensification of censorship around the world. Ben Garrison, I've been a fan of this guy for decades. He's one of the top political cartoonists in the world. You're a TV viewer on camera three. You can see him right there, punched up on our video feed with him here in Buck Rogers land. We're going to be talking to him here in just a moment. And popping into the bottom of the hour for a segment, because it all ties together, Ja'Kari Jackson is so brave. He got hit, what was it, in the head with a rock out in California and then out in Albuquerque, or was it in Albuquerque? He's been in New Mexico and in California the last few days. And then, of course, he got in Ferguson, just covering things, got hit with tear gas. Joe Biggs got shot with a rubber bullet. And you just see the anti-free speech frothing of the anti-Trump people. And they've also been going after Ben Garrison. So these are two peas in a pod. I've had the anti-Trump people call for, you know, myself to be arrested. And Salon has said we should just be shut off the internet. And now in Germany, the local reports, fines for online hate speech can run into the thousands of euros or arrest. And that ties into Mark Zuckerberg, who called his users dumb effers, coming out and telling Merkel he's going to censor people as well and not let them criticize open borders. I mean, even mild speech. So it's not coming, it's here. And Ben Garrison is one of the most heavily targeted because he's in newspapers and magazines all over the world. He's one of the top guys out there. And in the last decade or so, he's gotten even more libertarian, I would say. He can speak for himself. And they've been coming after him, really trying to get him kicked off mainstream media. But that doesn't really matter because mainstream media is dying. But I guess they're trying to cut off his money. That's why I guess he sells posters and stuff like that. It's important to support free speech, especially free speech that's pro-human, or you're going to lose it. So it's graphics.com, G-R-R-R, graphics. That's G with three R's, and then graphics.com. We're going to tweet that out and Facebook that out as well. Years ago, we have Ben Garrison art hanging on the wall, and it was crazy to later learn from him, and I guess he'll tell you in person today that some of his work is inspired by InfoWars, like The March of Tyranny. And if you're a radio listener, we'll also post an article in InfoWars, some of these specific ones, but go see all of them at graphics.com. Mr. Garrison graduated with a BA degree in art from Angelo State University, San Angelo, Texas, another good old Texas person. In 1979, he now lives with his wife, Tina, in Lakesville, Montana. He is a commercial artist, fine artist, and libertarian cartoonist. He was very, very angry in 2008. Banker bailout, decided to draw protest cartoons in his spare time. He began by drawing anti-Federal Reserve and pro-Ron Paul cartoons. And I got to say, he's probably one of the most prominent political cartoonist out there, probably the most. I mean, I've got to say, Anthony Fried is very prominent, but Ben Garrison is probably numero uno, and of course, he's a patriot. How many people that are number one aren't patriots? Because we're free market, we're pro-human, and our ideas are populist and resonate with the people. So if you're a radio listener, go to InfoWars.com/show. You can see these as we're talking to Ben Garrison. Ben, it's great to have you on. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Alex. Greetings from Montana.
Well, I'm kind of ranting here. We're all in the same boat together. You ought to just fill folks in that don't know on the attempts that have been out there to shut you up.
Well, I've had an avalanche of hate mail, most recently because of my Michelle Melania make the First Lady Great Again cartoon, and I knew that cartoon was nitroglycerin. And when I drew it for my Patreon members only. And I was just, because I want to give them some extras that, you know, non-supporters don't see. But then I decided to tweet it out. Okay, well, I'll just tweet it out so show people this is what my Patreon supporters get to see that I don't put on my website. And I knew it was explosive, but I didn't expect the magnitude of the explosion I received. I've got an avalanche of hate mail. I got many death threats. And I got a lot of reasonable emails, too. But one of the themes that sort of ran through there was that I wasn't being helpful. He said, your cartoons are not helpful. You're making the situation worse. And you need to stop being so mean. And they really missed the point of what an editorial cartoon is all about. Now, all editorial cartoons, in my opinion, are predicated on being mean, because we see government wrongdoing and we're angry. So that's the spark of the cartoon, is the anger and meanness. The other element necessary for the cartoon is some kind of an idea, and that's based on analogies or humor. And then the third element, of course, is the drawing. You need to have some modicum of drawing talent to be able to pull it all together. And when you pull it all together, it's satire. And people don't realize that a lot of people that these days, the politically correct crowd, don't realize what satire is. Satire is supposed to be mean. We're supposed to go after these people.
And it's the most protected speech in the world, according to common law in England and the United States. I mean, satire is the most protected.
Well, it should be. And so what I did is I pushed the envelope. I knew that people were going to be mad because these SJWs and, I mean, they're hothouse flowers. I said, okay, well, I'm going to need to toughen them up a little bit. So I'm going to draw a cartoon that's going to probably make them mad. And boy, did they get mad. And so, one of the things I was accused of right off the bat, of course, is I was racist, which the cartoon is not racist. Michelle is a public figure. She's fair game.
And she does look extremely masculine. I mean, there are a lot of women that I'm attracted to, a lot of black women I think are super sexy. And I'm here to tell you right now, she's not one of them. She looks too masculine.
Well, this is kind of the feminist dialogue. And I don't understand a lot about feminism. I'll tell you that right off the bat. But one of the things that seems to be coming into play now is that you have to appreciate all females in all forms, you know, whether they're overweight or they're old or this, that, and the other. I'm sorry that but men are not wired that way. We find some women more attractive than others.
Well, I mean, tell folks about the history of political cartoons for hundreds of years all over Europe and here. It's supposed to be goofy. They've done them myself where they make me look like a moron. And Obama, that's just what they do.
Well, that's what they do. But Alex, here's what they object to. A conservative is doing it. A conservative, especially a white conservative, is not allowed to criticize a black liberal in particular. And then a woman in particular. So if for such a simple cartoon, it was insulting to me.
It was in hundreds of newspapers. You were demonized. People called for your arrest. Newspapers asked if it was legal in Europe, where they're now arresting people. But here's the great news. It only made you more successful because you challenged them. I talked about it and said, hey, Joan Rivers, before she died, said that everybody knows Michelle Obama's a tranny. In fact, can we cue that tape up? And the media ran with it like I was the one saying it. I kind of tongue-in-cheek said, they've lied to us so much. Okay, I think she's a man. I mean, you know, maybe she's a space alien. Maybe Obama is. I mean, and then they came out against myself as well, which the great news is, Ben, for me, these are such discredited people. All it did was wake folks up. I think they're out of bullets. What do you think?
Definitely. The thing about that cartoon, too, is something as strange is going on in that marriage. I mean, she once sat down in an interview and said that she was a single mother. And then we have Obama calling her Michael several times, Michael. And it's obvious they can't stand each other. You see him getting off the plane, and Michelle is nothing but a scowl. And so that's one of the reasons I drew that, too, because usually the first lady has a smile on her face, and she's waving. She represents America, and she's happy. Now, Michelle, she sees racism everywhere. You might remember that incident at Target where some little old lady, short little old lady, asked her to reach for a box of detergent, and Michelle was offended. Oh, that's racist. You're asking me to help you just because I'm tall.
Absolutely. Little old ladies ask me stuff all the time. It's a form of affection. Also, she's always out eating, you know, fattening foods, ice cream, ribs, chicken fried steak, all the stuff I love to eat and shouldn't eat. And then she's lecturing our kids, telling them what to eat, and none of that tasty stuff is on the menu.
Well, that's the main reason I went after her, because she's forcing a nanny state program on the kids. And, you know, for basically forcing the kids to eat GMO foods and let the parents pay for it. Now, I come from, when I was a kid, I always had sack lunches, you know, and now it's like, when did the big government step in and tell parents what their kids, okay, so the kids are a little overweight. That's the parents' job to do something about that, not Michelle. So just the fact that she's living lavishly on the public dime and taking, you know, exotic vacations and enjoying the high life, that makes her a target in my eye. I mean, and the fact that I'm happen to be a white conservative drawing a black liberal does not make me racist. Now,
but Ben, let's go further. Any good political cartoonist takes real traits that are there and exacerbates it. I mean, that's just what you do. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I remember taking that, you know, in class.
She looks mannish to me. And you see the liberals praising her. Oh, look at those arms. They're ripped. Isn't she beautiful? Well, I don't find that beautiful. But
let's expand on that, though. You don't even really exacerbate that much, maybe a little bit. I'm going to put on screen for TV viewers the famous blue dress where it looks like she has a codpiece or a large package on screen for TV viewers. And then I'm going to cut to your graphic. And if you look at the two, I mean, you drew what you saw. Let's put it back on screen, guys. So there she is in a lot of photos. Looks like she's got a codpiece or maybe she's carrying a small handgun, you know, in her crotch. I mean, I'm serious.
That's a common internet meme, and she is subject to those kind of memes just like any other politician. They make fun of Trump with his small hands. Oh, he must have a very small package himself. Whoa, they can make fun of Trump, but boy, if you make fun of a liberal, here's the double standard, Alex. There are a lot of liberal cartoonists out there, and when they draw a conservative black politician or a black public figure, guess what? It's for example, I've seen liberal cartoonists draw Condi Rice, and they all but call her the pictorial equivalent of the N-word, or Clarence Thomas. They're putting KKK hoods on Clarence Thomas. They get away with it because they're on the left. Now, I do something like this, and oh my gosh, you're not only do you hate black women, you hate women. And then there
you you just hate Michelle Obama.
Right. I try to explain it. You know, of course, there are beautiful black women out there. You know, but I had one person say, "You hate black women. You hate transsexuals." Even Sulu. What's his name? George Takei was complaining that I'm anti-trans.
Oh, he jumps on every bandwagon. Stay right there, Ben Garrison. Graphics.com. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones.
And do you think that the country will see the United States will see the first gay president or the first woman president?
We already have it with Obama, so let's just calm down.
Got it.
You know Michelle is a trans.
I'm sorry, she's a what?
A transgender. We all know.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, gosh. It's okay. She does this.
Now, look, folks. When you force feed everybody this tranny stuff 24/7 to confuse the sexes and break down society, I'm not demonizing folks that are into it. The people pushing something that's 0.2% of the population, that's the issue. So Joan Rivers dead a few months after calling Obama gay, Michelle a tranny. She also called Obama gay. So there you go. My issue is this whole thing's pretty mysterious, but regardless, can a cartoonist just take a photo of her and do a drawing that's similar and not be demonized? This is an attack on free speech across the board. Ben Garrison is our guest. Jakari Jackson just got back from New Mexico and from California being attacked by the anti-Trump people. So he's going to be popping in with us as well. Why do you think they're intensifying their efforts to censor so much, Ben?
Well, that's a good question. I think it's a matter of control. I mean, look at that book, 1984, and how they pared down the language, because it's not just about controlling people. It's controlling their minds and controlling what they can say or can't say. I mean, I catch myself even doing it myself, because this is how political correctness is like an insidious acid that cuts through everything. I used the expression the other day, on the warpath, and I said, well, that might be insulting to Indians. I can't say on the warpath or sacred cow. You know, Michelle's not a sacred cow. Well, that can't say that. That's going to be insulting Indians or
but it's not to use somebody's cultural term. It's honoring that culture.
Right, but kids can't go out to Halloween anymore and dress up in an Indian costume because somehow they think that's insulting. Why would that be insulting? But this is we're being channeled now. We've got like guardrails on the freeway of free speech, and those guardrails are there to protect us, supposedly protect us from, you know, from haters and people who want to libel you and do wrongdoings. But the trouble is, these guardrails are now starting to narrow in, and there's only certain things you can say and not say. So it's a matter it's a matter of control. That's what it's about.
When did you do Attack of the Cry Bullies? Because I know that was before Trigglypuff was discovered out in California. You show Attack of the Cry Bullies, and it literally looks like Trigglypuff before she was discovered. I mean, I guess you'd seen other social justice warriors that looked like 300-pound babies, because that's what, I mean, I'm not being mean. It's like crazy to watch these folks.
Well, to me, that's what they are. You know, just a few years ago, I didn't know what a social justice warrior was. I thought they were good people. Maybe they worked at food banks or, you know, helped people get jobs or something like that. But then when I found out what they really were, I was like, okay, I gotta go after these people. These Black Lives Matter. You can't say All Lives Matter if you do. You're racist. It's like they don't understand that at college you're supposed to be open to free ideas and debate. That's what it's all about. It's not sure. about shutting people down, telling them to shut up, like Trigglypuff did.
Well, you're a total genius because before Trigglypuff was known, you actually, she had multicolored hair before. Now it's black. But I want to put this on screen for TV viewers. This is shocking that he literally drew Trigglypuff before he'd ever seen her image. Ben is like just incredible. I guess he saw a similar puff. But there's Trigglypuff, okay, the top social justice warrior. Now let's cut to Ben Garris's cartoon from months and months before. And in the safe space area is Trigglypuff, the exact same look, the exact same with a drink like a pacifier, the exact same build. And I'm not being mean. This is this, sir, how did you do this? How did you actually discover, when did you do this this Ben Garrison Attack of the Crybullies piece?
Oh, I can't remember what that was. I think that was done last year, but
yeah, actually, it's been out a while. So incredible, yeah, but, sir. Almost a year before she was discovered, you did it.
But I can't take all the credit for that. Part of it, I read a terrific book that everybody should read. It's called SJW's Always Lie by Vox Day. And I read that and I was like, it really opened my eyes. And I realized how I myself have been like channeled in by this political correctness. And,
I've been intimidated too.
I was ruled by fear because I didn't want to lose my job. You know, I saw all these people out there, all these trolls attacking me and calling me a racist. You know, HR departments have a tendency to look at that and they see somebody put my face on a Nazi uniform and I'm going to get passed over for work. And I still have to make a living. So I was operating out of anger and fear.
But you transcended it, and let me guess, I bet you're doing better than ever.
You know, that's really strange. Finally, I got to a point where I don't care anymore. You could call me whatever you want. And I got hundreds of hate mail, and I just looked at that, and I kind of shook my head. I'm sorry you wasted your time. It doesn't bother me at all. But as soon as I stopped caring, ironically, I've been busier this year.
Of course. You broke the trance. We'll be back.
We're on the march.
By the way, I've only had my crew a few times, I guess, talk to Mr. Garrison, and I guess a few emails from memories years ago. I was like, wow, this looks like some of my political statements and ideas. And later, we talked to Garrison. I'm just going from memory. He can correct me if I'm wrong. And a lot of his work, I'm honored, was inspired by some of my political perspective. Not even so much views, just how I saw things. We'll talk to him in just a moment. But now, just to see the stuff he's doing, it's just so cutting edge. It teaches me a lot of stuff about, you know, what's happening in the world. And look, going back to ancient times, whether it was in Japan or China or nation states in Europe or Africa or wherever, Latin America, a ballad or a gesture or people doing cartoons on the streets of Rome, chalking the walls, sometimes would start memes that would overthrow an emperor. And that's why they hate cartoonists. They hate the minstrels that are out there playing and saying their songs about corrupt King George or whatever, because historically, that's where the real power is. And as Facebook and the German government and the Chinese government and the White House and the Federal Elections Commission try to censor Drudge and Ben Garrison and Alex Jones and so many others, it just backfires. When the people are awake and get angry and take action, just like Ben Garrison just said, we're going back to him in a moment. When he was somewhat intimidated, he was still putting info out, but still self-censoring because he wanted to be nice. When he finally went, wait, these are bullies. They're trying to rule my life. I'm going to go all the way. He only got more popular. And I'll be honest, I'm not a coward, but I am a nice guy, and I'm Texas hospitality, and I want to get along with folks. And with the social justice warriors, I'd try to reach out. I'd try to say, listen, you've been deceived. No, I don't think that. And they'd spit in my face and call me a racist and a white devil. And this is white people going to, you know, Rob Dew and my crew that, you know, are like nice guys, kind of in hippie garb with long hair, because they're classical liberals. They call them ultra-right wingers because they're pro-gun, pro-family. Spitting in their faces going, you're an effing white male. And this is white guys saying, you don't get to talk because you're a white male. It's reverse racism. Well, of course, it's not reverse. Humans are humans. They can all do it. But it's white ruling class telling whites they don't have any speech and then, quote, telling the minorities, we rule you and you think like we think. That's what Garrison's saying. And we're going to Jakari Jackson as well here with our guest. But briefly, go to his site. Get his posters. Support what he's doing at grrgraphics.com, graphics.com in Garrison. Hang them up in your business. This is political weapons. Support him. Support us. That's what we do, and that's how we take back the culture. And I say it 1,000 times, just like you couldn't find organic food 30 years ago, people started just selling it. It was high cost because it was a small market. People started buying it. It made the market bigger, made it go down in cost, up in quality. We're now pushing the non-GMO off the store shelves. That's not a liberal or conservative issue. That's a common sense issue. It's the same thing. Tell folks about our free podcast, our iPhone, Droid apps, Infowars.com/show, the video feeds, the audio feeds. Sign up for the free newsletters, Infowars.com/newsletter. Send those video and article links out every day to everybody you know. That's what it's all about, is getting off the bench, not being beaten down, not being a victim, but taking action. Now, before I go any further, we're going to end this weekend. I was going to go to the end of the month, which is pretty much Monday, but we're going to have to probably end it Saturday or Sunday because we're going to run out, and I don't want to run out until more gets here in a month. 20% off Survival Shield, the good halogen, the bad halogen gets in, fills up your glands, your thyroid. I'd always heard this was important, and that iodine deficiency had caused massive IQ reductions. You can just search engine it, find mainstream news admitting it. But until I got on it 3 years ago, look at the weight I've lost. Look at the energy I have. Look how much better my skin is. I mean, this just sucked out so many of the bad halogens. It's such a game changer. Nobody else has true pure iodine. InfoWarsLife.com. I want to introduce this to you and your family. You've heard about it. You've read about it. Do yourself a favor. Start taking a few drops a day in your water or under the tongue. Consult your physician if you're going to give it to your children. If you already have thyroid problems, definitely consult your physician because you may already be so full of the bad stuff that, you know, this could cause a problem. We've never really heard that or seen evidence of that, but we're just saying it's serious. Super male vitality and female vitality. Concentrated herbs out for months. Now back in. InfoWarsStore.com. And I'm announcing a special that we're running through this weekend right now for Memorial Day that's coming up, where a lot of the items, I'm not going to list them all here, are 20 to 30% off depending on what product they are. 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion. Should have said this up front. For the first time ever, and it's a bestseller. So you can give it to veterans that you know who in so many times are in bad health because of the vaccines and all the rest of it. 30% off Bone Support Joint Formula. 30% off Liver Shield. Give the gift to a veteran today. Take action or get the discount for yourself. Maybe you're a veteran. Give yourself that discount and support the tip of the spear. So on this Memorial Day coming up, for the veterans and the patriots and all those that have fought and died for liberty, we want to just encourage you to get 30% off on three of our best sellers at InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com. Is the big umbrella site. And finally, 10% off when you sign up for AutoShip on top of those discounts. Cancel anytime, and free shipping on orders of $50 or more. There are so many specials at InfoWarsStore.com and InfoWarsLife.com. I can't get to them all. I'm going to stop right there, but check it out for yourself. And know that financing what we do, shopping with the good guys, is helping build a media organization that is sending shockwaves across the country and the world. Now, we're going to Jakari Jackson to ride shotgun with us here in about 2 minutes, but getting back to Ben Garrison, who also rides shotgun with us, he's the award-winning editorial cartoonist, who was just a fine artist until, he ought to tell you his story because it's such a success story. I can say now he's probably the top editorial cartoonist out there. I know I see his stuff everywhere. I see it painted on murals. I see people referring to it. It shows the power of an idea. Ben, I've been ranting, but finish up your point about not backing down and then you exploded in popularity even more and other key points.
Yeah, once I gave up my fear of losing my job, because you know, that's what SJWs go after. They go after your livelihood. And I was in an art gallery for several years up here in Montana, and so they all ganged up and attacked the owner of the art gallery. And she was so upset by that, I had to leave because she didn't like the bad publicity. So they go after your, they want to break your rice bowl. There's another politically incorrect thing to say, but they tried to break mine, and on all the hate mail, there was a common theme through it that one person says, I'm not going to rest until you're broken homeless. They want to break.
These are evil people.
Cartoon, right. So they don't want to debate the ideas that's inherent in the cartoons that I'm perfectly happy to discuss with them. What they want to do is they want you dead. I had so many death threats. I want you dead. Why aren't you dead yet? I told you to die already. You know, so it just goes on and on. And because they can't, they seem to be incapable of debate, because the reason why is everything is predicated on their feelings. They're all feelings based. And if their feelings get hurt, it's like they start calling you names. They call you a racist, which is the equivalent of calling you a heretic back in the Spanish Inquisition. And once you get called a heretic, then you're no longer part of the human family. And then you could be demonized and burned at the stake. So that's what they do. You're a racist, therefore you're not a human being, therefore burn you at the stake and you need to die. That's what it's almost like a religious fervor.
Well, they hate your artwork because it smashes the left-right paradigm. It shows what authoritarians they are. Now I'm very honored. You sent me some notes about some of the graphics we were going to show. The March of Tyranny. You said, quote, this is one of my most famous and iconic cartoons. We have it hanging on the wall here. I drew it in 2010 after hearing Alex describe the Republican leg, the Democratic leg, marching and stepping on people. In reality, I should have signed his name to it since it was his idea. Well, I think it's beyond that, but I'm honored.
That was in 2010, and I was listening to your program, and you described this cartoon exactly. I mean, it's really your cartoon, but when I heard you say that, I said, well, I got to draw that right now. And I didn't have the time. So what I did is I got a Sharpie pen out and I drew it in 3 hours, not realizing that it's going to become my iconic cartoon. But you, when you speak, I mean, you use a lot of rich metaphors. And that's one of the things that is needed for a good cartoon. Good cartoons are always using analogies and metaphors. And many of my other cartoons are derived from things you said.
Well, I'm honored. Well, I've said a lot of things off cartoons you've done now. So the circle is now complete.
A little reciprocity there.
Well, I mean, because you've really made me have some original thoughts as well in you know, seeing this. And of course, for so long, they've controlled both parties. So it is a left-right march. Trump is sabotaging that as a populist. I don't like Sanders, but so is he. And that's why it's so great they've agreed to debate, because even if Sanders would, you know, hurt us overall, the establishment doesn't like him. And so this really, you know, to me shows a kind of breaking of the left-right paradigm.
Well, me too. The main reason, and I don't agree with everything Trump has said, but the good thing about Trump too is he's also willing to change. When he realizes he's wrong, he's able to change. It doesn't set in his heels. But when I saw the establishment go after him tooth and nail, I say, wow, I got to pay attention to this guy. And also, he's not afraid of the political correctness, which is really gotten long in the tooth. I mean, political correctness, I mean, come on, it's jumped the shark a long time ago. People have got to start standing up against it and stop caring what they're getting, the names they get called. But, and then that epitomizes Trump. He does not care what anybody calls him. And when you look at the liberal cartoonists attacking him, what do they do? It's always the same thing. It's, oh, Trump is Hitler. You know, Trump is a racist. Trump is this. It's just name calling. There's no argument there. There's no depth to the cartoon. It's just, you know,
there's an attempt to poison the well. There's no reality to it. No, I want to play a clip here of other political persecution. This is Jakari Jackson, and he's been hit with tear gas before. Our crew's been rubber bulleted. You know, he got hit with a rock when he was covering things the last few days. He's about to join us because he's somebody else who has the courage to stand up against the bullying. But here's a clip of some of the things Jakari's been through.
You guys know I don't like that stuff. This guy's going out. Yeah, man. Bro, you sent me with a freaking rock. What's your name, bro? You sent me with a rock. You. Yeah, you.
The guy hits the car with a rock and runs off. But we don't call a white guy or a Hispanic guy hitting a black guy with a rock racist. Who knows if it was? It would be called that if it was a liberal being hit. And there he is out there in the smoke. But these are really wartime reporters, people like Jakari and Joe Biggs and Josh Owens and Rob Dew and all of them. Darren McBrain, they've all been. And you got folks here in the shot in the moment with Mexican flags. And again, you don't go to Mexico and run around with American flags. There's this idea of trampling America. Let's bring Jakari in from one of the TV studios. Jakari, you've been sitting there listening to Garris in the last 20 minutes or so. I know that you follow his cartoons as well. I really think the social justice warriors have gone too far. It's not that the right wing's perfect. It's not that Donald Trump's perfect. I know you're not even really a Trump supporter. But it has reached a new level, in my view. Do you think that's accurate, or what's your view on all this, Jakari?
Well, when you talk about the social justice warriors, you know, like what I encountered going out to Albuquerque and to Anaheim, these people were so self-righteous, and they said, well, Donald Trump supports, you know, violence and all this stuff. And you see all like one or two clips in the past, some guy wearing a Trump hat shoving somebody. But that's a completely different level than what we saw at Albuquerque, where people were burning flags, throwing stuff at cops. They threw a barricade at a horse. They tried to kick the door of the convention center in. And I'm saying, I don't know how you can equate those two things. Like, that's minor, you know, stuff between one or two people, like some Trump guy shoving people. Meanwhile, you have a mild riot out here where they're attacking police, and they feel it's justified because Donald Trump said something they didn't like.
Sure. Likewise, what about this punk hitting you in the head?
You don't see any people going out to these Bernie rallies, no Trump supporters going to these Bernie rallies, to these Hillary rallies, and doing these similar type of things.
Exactly. Imagine if Trump supporters went out and started throwing rocks at people. Tell us about this punk that hit you in the head with a rock.
Yeah, so I do have a correction to that video I put out. It wasn't tear gas, it was smoke. So I do offer apology to the Albuquerque Police Department. It's not CS gas, that was smoke. But what that was, they released the smoke out there, and people were throwing rocks. So they had been doing this for several hours, throwing, you know, all manner of things. We even have a video of somebody throwing a burning flag at one of the officers. And some guy was behind me, and I'm looking around, and he gets a handful of rocks. So he wasn't throwing it at me per se, but I was in his field of view, and one of the rocks kind of veered off, and it hit me in the head. And I turn around, and I'm noticeably upset about this. I was like, hey, man, you just hit me in the head with a rock. You know, what's going on here? And I tried to get a good shot of his face. I couldn't get a shot of his face because he took off. But this is the type of actions that were going on out there. And this is just one person who was throwing rocks. I'm pretty sure many other people in the crowd were hit by rocks.
That's what you caught on tape. And to be clear, you were tear gassed, though, in Ferguson.
I was tear gassed in Ferguson, Missouri, and I do have the CS gas canister to prove that. So, yeah, I was tear gassed in Ferguson, Missouri, but in Albuquerque they used.
Well, Jakari, let me raise this point with you, because obviously we have Ben Garrison here. They got him kicked out of his art gallery that was his main source of funding. He doubled down and didn't back off. They've, you know, hit you with rocks. They've attacked other people. We've had the anti, pro-life people come out and attack us just covering a pro-life event. I mean, I think it's fair to say 9 times out of 10, the so-called left out here is vehemently anti-free speech. I don't see how shutting down or trying to shut down Ben Garrison or hitting you in the head with a rock or attacking a police horse, which, by the way, is very dangerous, folks. A lot of horses will trample you and attack you. Police horses
aren't menaced. Yeah, I was very impressed with how they kept those horses calm. I thought the same thing while I was out there. I was like, these horses are going to kill somebody when all that was happening.
Oh, yeah, because they don't get horses that are, you know, that skittish. These are usually mixed in with quarter horses and Clydesdales, and will attack people. I would attack somebody. I want to say you have a lot of restraint, Jakari, not chasing that guy down. If somebody hit me in the head with a rock, I'd have a lot of trouble.
Yeah, I was pretty mad when that happened, because what happens when you go out to these rallies? Because I meet so many people like, oh, it's so cool, you're out in Ferguson, all this stuff. You have to understand, guys like that, the guy who hit me with a rock, he was in the back of the crowd throwing stuff towards the front of the crowd. They did the same thing in Ferguson, Missouri, the people who decided to throw bottles and stuff at the cops. They used a sea of humanity as a human shield between them and the police officers and tried to engage the officers that way. And what happens when they get caught on camera? They take off and run, just like that, you know, that punk who's running behind me right there.
Ben Garrison,
these are the type of actions.
What do you think about this unified theme of censorship, attacking free speech? And these people are so stupid. They're of every race, color, and creed, but they're unified in their ignorance. And like Jakari said, they're so self-righteous. What do you think is going on here?
A lot of it, what I just saw there, is they're able to attack in an anonymous way, and they don't take responsibility. And so there's no accountability or responsibility intrinsic into their free speech. So they're able to have it an advantage, an unlabeled level playing field. And I've been accused many times, well, I'm hiding out in the boonies of Montana. You're not taking responsibility for all the hate that you're creating, and it's affecting our children. They always pull that one on me, too. But you know what? I signed my own name to these cartoons, my own real name.
John Hancock.
And people can write me and complain if they have a complaint. So that's an open discourse. But what they're doing with this, what they're doing is pretty good example of hate speech, but what that is, it's a tyrannical speech, because it shuts down debate. If you call somebody a racist, or you're a bigot, or you're this or that and the other, there can be no
look,
debate.
It's illiberal, it's anti-freedom, it's anti-free speech. Ben Garrison and Jakari Jackson are both our guests. We're going to come back with Mr. Garrison, finish up with him, show some more of his cartoons. I'm going to do a few more minutes with Jakari, and then Tim Kennedy. Ben Gunderson's our guest. We've got Dakari Jackson with us as well. And I went back there to just talk to Tim Kennedy for like 3 minutes during the break and didn't ask him, hey, you want to come on at 1:30 instead of coming on from 1 to 1:30, because we're back there working. I'm in a whole bunch of stuff we're going to be working on. It's pretty exciting. I tell you, we are not idle here at InfoWars. They say that idle hands are the devil's workshop. Well, there are no idle hands or brains around here, but that's good to be like a whirlwind of activity instead of just kind of, you know, sitting there thinking the world's boring. And I think things are going to get a lot crazier. I want to ask Dakari Jackson this. Also want to ask Ben Garrison this. Do you think the social justice warrior insanity is starting to peak, or is this just the beginning of their imitation of the Maoist youth brigade takeover of China? Dakari?
I would like to say that it's peaked, but every place I go, it seems to have ratcheted up. You know, whether it's in Ferguson or the more recent events that I've been covering here lately, you go to the colleges, people are just getting more and more bold. And I think what it is, it's you have a steady stream of new college students who get sucked into these groups, whether they be the anarchist groups or the communist groups, whatever else, and they feel justified to go out here and do these type of behaviors. Like I talked to those guys afterwards, after the Albuquerque thing, and they said, well, we feel justified to come out here and do this. And I said, bro, I'm not even a Trump supporter, but Trump's not the one out here burning American flags, throwing barricades at horses and rocks at protesters. How can you blame him for something like that? And they feel justified in doing so.
Let me ask Ben this question, and then I want to go back to you after the break, Dakari, and do one more segment with Dakari Jackson. There are really not a lot of jobs for most of these college degrees now, and so it's a perfect time bomb to have millions of people every few years going into college. There's no future, and there's the Ford Foundation with Commie Light to teach them how to now be basically social justice warriors. I mean, the establishment is behind this, Ben. What's your take on that?
I think you're right, and it's also spreading into regular media. For example, when they published that First Lady cartoon I drew, I mean, I first saw it on Yahoo. I was looking through Yahoo headlines, and the headline said, if you agree with this cartoon, you're part of the problem. And I said, well, what cartoon is that? And guess what? It was mine. And so then I thought, well, what kind of investigative journalism are they doing? They don't even do basic journalism. They didn't call me for my opinion. Neither did the Daily Mail or any other mainstream outlets that wanted to. It's not about contacting me. It's about playing this ain't it awful game that reinforces the social justice echo chamber, because they like to do this strutting and the scolding and the, what is it called, virtue signaling amongst each other. It's a status to go after people that they're really inventing a lot of nonsense that...
Exactly, and it's a status to be following the latest download of dribble. One of my favorites is your citizen cattle one. That the good left is against GMO and, you know, dangerous vaccines. A lot of folks on the left are really smart. They're not this new cult of people. I mean, that is a powerful cartoon. And most of your stuff over the years was more libertarian, some of it even progressive. These people are so evil to call you racist.
Well, I came from a liberal background. I worked for newspapers for 20 years. I worked at the Seattle Post-Intelligencer. I did work for them until it closed down in 2008. So I know all about, you know, I've kind of a...
So these are definitely new type of liberals. I mean, there have been a lot of classical liberals are really cool people.
I don't consider the SJWs to be liberals, because liberals, you are able to have a conversation with them and a debate with them. It's just their feelings and yelling and screaming. And it's starting to we got to stop. We got to start pushing back against these people right now. If we start doing it right now, then maybe it is the peak. They're not going to get any more traction and get it infiltrated into rest of the media.
We didn't get to some of the points about Trump versus Hillary and why we must end the Federal Reserve's dysfunctional system of money and some of the other things. I want to invite you back in the next few weeks for the nightly news. Ben Garrison, it's amazing to talk to you, you know, basically here in person. Thank you so much for the time, and we really look forward to speaking to you again. Please keep up your amazing work.
Thank you very much, Alex, and thanks for your help with my cartoons.
You bet, brother. You're awesome.
Thank you.
All right, Tim Kennedy is going to be in here at 20 after for the balance of this hour. Then David Knight takes over a fresh horse in the fight in the fourth hour. We're going to talk about military scandals, a lot of the things that are happening at the overseas, nothing classified. But let's just say a lot of interesting things are going to be discussed coming up in the balance of the hour that I'm going to be hosting here. In the next segment, I got a bunch of Trump news and election news I didn't get to. I still haven't gotten to the Katie Couric scandal. I want to cover that. But getting back to Dakari Jackson. Dakari, you know, we don't script these interviews and talks, obviously. But just in the whole state of the world, the way you've seen things change the last 3+ years you've been here, what is your sense of where the planet is today, where America is today?
Well, in the short time I've been here, I guess it's been close to 4 years now, but relatively short compared to the amount of time that you've been on the air, I've seen a lot more political activeness, and that's not necessarily a good thing. Just like you were talking about some of the things we've done earlier, whether it's the abortion rallies or some of the political rallies, you see so many people who are fired up and self-righteous, and I do respect people for getting up and, you know, in the game, you know, spending their time to go protest or call their congressman or whatever else, but they get so self-righteous that they actually think it's fine to inflict violence upon other people, and I think that's a growing trend that's really disturbing. What will stem that, I don't know, but they get so caught up on various issues, and a lot of times they're mad about things they don't even understand, or it's just a talking point that they heard. And I think that's a very important thing, Alex. I was thinking while I was out here at this Albuquerque rally, you know, I don't even support Trump, but Trump never said he wants to deport all Muslims. That was a common thing I kept hearing. I was like, when did he say that? Where's the video clip of him saying that? And then other things, talking about people come over the border and all manner of other things. He says a lot of stuff, but a lot of people were just mad about stuff that was not even an issue, things that never even happened.
And they'll also act like Trump already ran the country and already caused all the problems, but Hillary...
Oh, that was a huge one, Alex. People kept saying to me, oh, we got all these bought and paid for politicians. I'm like, people were bought and paid for long before Donald Trump. The economy this, the economy was messed up. Jobs that, the job market was already messed up. You're blaming Donald Trump for things that are not his fault. These things have been happening for years, probably longer than most of these people have even been alive, the people at these demonstrations.
Exactly. So let's expand on that briefly, because this is violence. Hitting somebody is violence. Calling and getting them to lose their job is a form of violence. But when the guy goes and puts fag on the cake to try to sue and get money from Whole Foods and make himself a victim, and then they show that when he left it wasn't on the cake, the news wouldn't even say in the headline that he'd done a false flag. They just said, oh, he's dropped his suit, because they kind of liked what he did. It just shows that this is bullying. This is a movement of bullying, and the left is out of control. That's all I'm saying. I've never been a big basher of the left, but, man, they're just out of control, Jakari.
Yeah, and specifically with that cake deal, I thought it was so ridiculous that in his statement, he didn't actually apologize, if I remember correctly. He was like, they did nothing wrong. He didn't say, I completely made this up. I need to apologize for making them look bad. It wasn't even like something that's blown out of proportion or a miscommunication. He completely made it up from the ground up. And he just left it alone. He's like, oh, they did nothing wrong. I thought that was a very weak retort to the Whole Foods countersuit.
Jakari, what's your gut tell you about the election 2016? You think it's going to be Hillary or Trump?
I mean, honestly, I think Trump does have the momentum. But when I see people who are so passionately against Trump, just like we saw in Albuquerque, I really don't know. Many of them were Bernie supporters. So I don't know if they would go from Bernie to Hillary. I think Hillary's going to get the nomination, you know, whether
sure. Hook or Biden. Why do you think Bernie supporters are so hateful?
That's a good question. And that's the thing I was trying to figure out. There's even a point I was talking to people about white privilege, and they said, well, Trump has white privilege, but Bernie doesn't. I was like, can you quantify that? And it's basically they were mad at Trump because I guess his parents had money or something like that. And it was just something that simple that, you know, his parents, you know, did what they could to provide sure. a life for him, and that made him a bad person.
Don't people get, though, that when there's money generally in a free market, that means other people can end up getting wealthy? I mean, you get rid of the rich people, you literally everything implodes. Great job, Jakari, out there in California. Tim Kennedy is obviously a famous combat Green Beret, most of what he's done secret, but I know people in the military know the stuff he's done. He's right up there with Chris Collar beyond just in his sniper activities. And then he's done all the rest of the commando stuff you can imagine in tours all over the world. And I guess he's still involved in a lot of stuff today, but we'll just leave it at that. But he is an Austinite. He lives here in Austin. He's good friends with my high school friend, Shane Steiner. They train together. And we've been working a lot with him behind the scenes in the last year or so. And pretty soon we're going to have some exciting things to be announcing here on air. I'll just leave it at that. But he's in some of the most secretive elite military units there are. And you know, he's told us here on air, the military is super awake to the New World Order, the whole nine yards now. And that really gives the globalist a big problem. That's not hype when I talk about the fact that our military knows that our country's been taken over by foreign interest. I mean, the TPP, global government, it's out in the open. And then the type of training they've got some of these folks going through really wakes them up and, you know, finishes the complete wake-up call. Like, they knew that Jade Helm was to condition the public for martial law in America. It was also for overseas. They knew that before I even knew about it. And they knew that I never said it was going to be martial law last summer. They just lied and said I said that. Military listens to the show. They know what I actually said. And that's the big problem that MSNBC, CNN, and others have, the New York Times, is that they just can't sit there and lie in a vacuum anymore. Now, we've been talking about this 3 days. It's been on the nightly news twice. I've mentioned it, but I want to cover it and play it now because I just got to get this done here on the actual broadcast, you know, the big daily show. This came out. InfoWars Daily Caller, Drudge carried it. I think it was when the Washington Free Beacon first got it. But Shock Audio, Katie Couric, gun documentary to silence pro-gun opinions. And she put out this documentary that just came out this month. And folks that were in the documentary were smart enough to wear wires or just, you know, record it on their phone so that when she did this, they could then on the internet go show what she really did. And one of their favorite tactics, I know you know this, but your neighbors may not know. And so you think the public's already upset? Start teaching people the tricks they use. They'll do stuff like I'm in a documentary and there'll be a 500 people in the crowd. I mean, I've had crowds of 5,000 before, but 500 in the crowd, jam-packed speaking at UT. They will cut to during the lunch hour to two or three people sitting there in the bleachers eating a sandwich. And I'm giving my speech like I gave a speech to two people. Or they will, you know, do unflattering shots and light you wrong. This is the type of stuff they do. But that's only the beginning. They'll also edit things where they ask you a question and then cut to you giving another answer you gave to something completely different to make you sound dangerous or bad. A lot of folks say, well, then let's just not even talk to the mainstream media. No, I say go out and talk to them and then go back and tell the true story of what they really did. But gun documentary misrepresents pro-gun voices, Washington Free Beacon, seen from the documentary called Under the Gun, intentionally edited video to make pro-gun owners and Americans appear dumbfounded when the host asked them questions about if there are no background checks for gun purchasers, how do you prevent felons and terrorists from purchasing a gun? Well, they all give incredibly good answers. We're going to play the audio in a moment. But when you watch the video, they go, because they just sit there rolling footage while they make you wait for like 10 minutes while you're talking to each other. And folks will kind of pause and kind of, that's what they do. Then they edit that together to make her look smart. Gun owners look dumb. Of course, their answers were, criminals don't go get background checks. Criminals steal guns. Criminals buy illegal guns. You know, they gave real answers. Highest gun rate of crime is in areas where the guns have been taken, like Chicago, New York, or D.C. They all responded with good answers, but you didn't get to see their answers. And that's like pouring sugar in somebody's gas tank before they start the Indy 500. And then saying, oh, look, you know, this car lost or whatever, or the Daytona, whatever. This is the deception. And I know you know about it, but man, when Glenn Beck gets up and says, I'd like to get up on stage and stab Donald Trump and wouldn't stop stabbing, and then says he didn't say that, and then his other has a co-host on, talking about we need a good American, you know, if Congress won't stop him to take him out, and then Drudge links to an article about it, and they go, Drudge is a despicable, horrible, lying scumbag because he lied and said we said that. You did. You did. You did say that. And I'm tired of it. And so we're watching you. We're aware of what you're doing. We know how you spin things. So let's go to the misrepresentation from the documentary. Here it is.
Let me ask you another question. If there are no background checks for gun purchasers, how do you prevent felons or terrorists from purchasing a gun?
And they just look down. It's that Perry Mason moment. They're destroyed. Oh, my gosh. She got them. If you're a radio listener, you can't obviously see it. When you see the video, it is ridiculous. I mean, look at this woman. Preying on the American people. She thinks we're all idiots. She's got the cute girl, little blue eyes, and a nice little smile of the cheerleader mom. She's a predator. She's a liar trying to rob you of your rights when she lives behind walls and has bodyguards on record. Like our whole other political class that want you disarmed as their quarry. So, They're all dumbfounded. They can't answer. When truth, that showed them just sitting around during breaks. We're going to take a break now. They're rolling to get the clips of you looking like you're idiots. Looking down. Oh, he got caught. Oh, my gosh. This guy's just, oh, he looks down. He's, the truth is, she's got a gun out, putting the cylinder in it, so they're looking at the gun. They even go, look, a gun. Oh, to make them look down like they've been defeated. I mean, scripting it all to rob you of your Second Amendment, just like they want to rob you of your First Amendment. These are dangerous, horrible totalitarians. Now, let's go ahead and go to the next clip. It's a couple minutes long. It's 4 minutes long. I'm not going to play the whole thing, but this is audio of what was really going on when she asked that question. Here it is.
If there are no background checks, how do you prevent, I know how you all are going to answer this, but I'm asking anyway, if there are no background checks for gun purchasers, how do you prevent felons or terrorists from walking into, say, a licensed gun dealer and purchasing a gun?
Well, one, if you're not in jail, you should still have your basic rights, and you should go buy a gun.
So if you're a terrorist or a felon?
If you're a felon and you've done your time, you should have your rights.
Well, the fact is, we do have statutes, both at the federal and state level, that prohibit classes of people from being in possession of firearms. If you're under 18 in Virginia, you can't walk around with a gun.
Let's stop right there. For the next 4 minutes, these people get better answers than I can give, a syndicated talk show host of 20-plus years. But it doesn't matter. She just rigged the whole deal. And she knows they're smart. She goes, look, I know you're already know your answers, but just give them to me. That's just to make them feel like they weren't being set up. And then she puts it out that they couldn't answer. That is a Brian Williams-level liar. She needs to be out of the business of media. She is a deceiver. I would never think about doing that, even to my political enemies. If they give good answers, we go, wow, they made a good point, which is rare, but we will show it. There was some anti-Trump folks made some good points. We put the videos out on the news. We go out and show, you know, 9 out of 10 liberals wanting to ban guns and put gun owners in FEMA camps. We show every single person we talk to, unless they're cussing and say nothing. That's the difference, because we have integrity, folks. We wouldn't do that to you. We respect you, because you know why? I respect myself. And I don't treat people like I don't want to be treated. It's that simple. And Lord knows it doesn't mean I'm perfect, but man, I tell you, these people are just preying on us. They're predators. They're predators. Katie Couric is a predator. Brian Williams is a predator. Hillary Clinton is a lying predator. And let me tell you, predators come looking like, you know, a good-looking middle-aged woman. Just like they come dressed in a nice suit trying to get kids, you know, into their van. And it's the same thing. It's the same attitude. She's a despicable person. And guess what else Facebook's been censoring? You try to push that article or these videos about it, I've been noticing that they're trying to block it. Because they don't want you to know. They don't want another one of their little generals to be brought down. Now I'm going to stop right there. We got Memorial Day coming up on Monday. And I want to just encourage absolutely everyone out there to be involved in the answer to taking this country and this world back. And folks love, you know, different holidays, and they love a sale associated with it. So I thought, you know what? I thought of this morning. I said, let's do 30% off vitamin mineral, amino acid fusion, fruit punch drink. That's one of the best, you know, things out there, because you absorb more of it. It's so key. And the bone support and joint support, 30% off both those. And 30% off Liver Shield and the Liver Cleanse. Consult your physician before you do any of these, because they're generally seen as safe, but it's still, you should consult your physician, because this is real stuff. 20% off will end this weekend. But you know what? Well, I'm going to sell out. I can't extend it. I was thinking about going 30% for this too, but I can't do it. 20% off on Survival Shield X2, the good halogen, that's going to end. And we got a lot of other products, big sales. Super Male Vitality's out of the gates. You know what? I'm going to say, even though it just came back in, been sold out for 2 months, for Veterans Day, if you're a veteran, give yourself the gift, a gift, you know, supporting us, supporting you. Back Memorial Day, I know. I teleprompter free. I know it's Memorial Day. Anyways. The point is that I am going to give you the gift, and I want to give you the gift of supporting us back as well. I'm doing 30% off Super Male right now. I'm doing 30% off Supermail right now, even though this is our best-selling product. I'm going to have them change that right now, and so you can have introductory use of this and see how great it is. For Memorial Day and for our veterans and our patriots and everybody else, I'm doing a 30% off on that product as well. We'll add that. So take action today. Also, Hillary for Prison shirts. Be sure and get those. We'll be back with Tim Kennedy. Well, folks, we've got Tim Kennedy in studio with us till the end of the hour, and then David Knight takes over. I want to cover the waterfront, some news we haven't hit with him. He was just already over here, working with the crew on some things. And I said, Tim, when you're here, we ought to just get you on air. So it's kind of an accident that he's here. But in the future, he's going to be here a little bit more. He's got a lot of big, I guess, UFC news will be coming out in the future. And he's been on a big tour for the troops, a whole bunch of places. But we're going to be doing some fun stuff together here that you'll be seeing on radio and TV in the near future. Tim Kennedy, one of the top UFC fighters in the world. But I never even announced him as that because I happen to know it's your Army career that's mainly secret from folks I know in Special Forces that's the real superstar thing. But you guys don't like to brag like the quiet professionals, my friend. So it's good to have you here with us.
God, it's lovely to be back in Austin.
It's awesome to have you, brother.
I love this place.
It's amazing. Well, here you are. Yeah, you live in Austin, but not much. You're a busy guy.
Yeah. Just got back from, where was I? Afghanistan, Kuwait, Kosovo, Romania, Bulgaria, Ireland, just visiting troops. You know, kind of, it was weird. For the first time in my life, flying into a combat zone without a gun. We had a security detail. You know, I was traveling with the Joint Chief of Staff. And so they had like a huge, gigantic security detail. I was like, where's my gun? Do I get a gun? No, they're like, no, bro, you're here as a celebrity. Like, you're here as a UFC fighter.
So you felt naked.
Oh, my God.
Now, you got your gun on you today, though.
Always.
Let's see that, baby. What do you usually carry when you're carrying something smaller?
Yeah, always the Glock 43. You know, it's just small, easy, concealable.
Nice.
Slides into anything, anywhere. You know, depends on where I'm going, what I'm doing will dictate what I'm carrying. You know, sometimes it's under here, sometimes small on my back, sometimes it's on my hip, sometimes it's my waist. I live in Austin. It's super hot here, so shorts, tank tops.
But you need to, because they've told you you're one of the top ISIS targets in the country.
Yeah, they're still trying to kill me. It's really funny. They should get over this. They suck at killing people. Unless they're unarmed.
Women or children.
Yeah, women or children or journalists, you know, or you know, women at a New Year's Eve parade in Germany, because Merkel just let them in. But I don't know why. They just won't let me go. It's because they suck and we're good at our job and they're all eventually just going
to. Are you happy to see that pressure, public pressure, is finally making Obama take out some of the ISIS people?
It's crazy that it has taken public pressure to dictate our president in chief to go execute Taliban leaders. How is that? How is it that public opinion? What are we, Rome now, where it takes public opinion for us to go and kill a Taliban terrorist? These guys are the evil of evil. They'll do anything to achieve to wipe out us off the face of the planet. And it takes public opinion for somebody for us to go.
Well, that is the good news, though. In the last 4 years, the Pentagon, really for the first time ever, had to restrain Obama from backing ISIS and then Al-Qaeda in Syria. And then it took public opinion and the military saying, let's take these guys out. But the good news is they are starting to collapse in some areas. At least that's the intel I'm getting and what I'm seeing in some of the news. Is that accurate?
Yeah, it's really magical that, you know, like, hey, we'll pull the troops out of Iraq because, you know, that's what I said I was going to do when I was on the campaign path. So then I do that and I create this monster called ISIS. Now I'm putting troops back into Syria, back into Afghanistan, back into Iraq to do what you said you didn't want to do, is have boots on the ground. But now that we're back, we're going to do what we always do, which is kill them. If you're bad and you're hurting people, you're destroying democracy, we're going to bury you.
Well, all I know is they certainly have tried to open that door into Turkey and into Europe of these people, millions of them. A lot of folks have called this a secret tattoo with these sleeper cells. I know you can't get into classified stuff, but just dead reckoning of millions of these folks have come in, upwards of 5 million in the last 3 years, into Europe, most of them military-age men, and we've seen the attacks already happen. And here's a headline out of Germany, fines for online hate speech, that's criticizing radical Islam and open borders, 1,000 euros. I mean, how big could this be? How big could these sleeper cells be?
They're gigantic. They're not could be. They are. There's no question about if in Brussels, in Germany, in the UK, if they exist. We know they exist, and we know that they're already currently planning to do horrific things all throughout Europe. I have friends that work in special operations there, and talking face to face is like, you know, what are you guys doing? They're like, honestly, I don't know if there's anything that we can do now to stop what they've already started. Like, we're so far behind now because of legislation, because of policy, that I don't know if we can rebound and save Europe. They really, these are special operations guys that think that they have already lost their country.
Well, 80% are military age men. They quote on Facebook that they were already in all these combat zones. They're proud of themselves. And as you know, Interpol admits they've allowed a bunch of them to come in. What do you think Merkel and Hollande are thinking, Tim Kennedy?
They can't be thinking. Either they're so ignorant and complacent that they should be removed from office, or there is a plan in place that they are letting happen, that they are, by this passive aggressive way, standing back and letting these millions of people come into their countries that will eventually destroy the version, all versions of what their countries have ever been. Their culture, their way of life, Germany, gone.
The dominant form of Islam, I mean, I'm preaching the choir here, it really does keep women as slaves. They're not allowed to drive cars, and now they're trying to set that up here. I want to come back and talk about what do we do, because you're a guy that war games this, and you know a lot of people that also war game it. What are they thinking is coming? You already kind of told us. They think Europe's pretty much already gone, and that's kind of what the Pope came out and said. We'll be back. Tim Kennedy is our guest. We've got Memorial Day coming up, and I want to get back into what's happening in Europe, what's happening here with the jihadists. But first, I want to play a clip that the mainstream media is making fun of, where he was supposed to speak out in Anaheim, California. We had our reporters there covering it, Joe Biggs. And Donald Trump gets up, and the organizers tell him, oh, the media told us they've got to go live now, so we're not going to have the national anthem. And Trump walks over and says, no, we're going to have the national anthem. And the media spun this like he was just pulling on heartstrings, acting like he's a patriot. Folks, this is how he does his events to honor America that's being run on the ground. You're not supposed to even have an American flag in public school now. They're calling it gang paraphernalia. If they can remove the flag, they can remove all other symbols. And sure, America's done some bad things. You can say the flag, you know, is a symbol sometimes of like slavery, but we got rid of it. You know, it was America first and England that pushed for that. So if they can get rid of the flag, they can do anything. But it was more about telling the media, you're not going to run our world. You're not going to tell us what to do. So many events we've put on and other folks have put on, the mainstream media shows up and is arrogant and dictates to everyone what you're supposed to do. And so I thought it was beautiful that he came up and said, no, we're going to do it. But see, what they really didn't want was him associated with a Star Spangled Banner that they want out of style. They didn't want that patriotic display. They wanted to take that away, sabotage Trump, and he sees through them. And nobody else would do that. But with his media savvy, he's able to do it. So let's go ahead and play a clip of how Donald Trump responded when they tried to not have the Star Spangled Banner.
Here's what happened. I got here, and they all said, we have a great crowd. We don't have time for the national anthem. I said, yes, we do. We have time for the national anthem. Right? And we have a young lady that is going to sing. And I said, what are you doing? She said, well, I was supposed to sing, but they had time because of the television cameras. They couldn't do it. I said, guess what? We're going to do the national anthem. Okay?
You're
so, Jerry Wilkins, come up. Jerry, come on, Jerry.
And you know, we're going to have her sing it since they don't want this to be heard. And then I'm going to get Tim Kennedy's take. Why are they so afraid of Americana? I mean, it's just, this is what made this country great. Even if we've been hijacked, the elite run the country. Why would they want to get rid of this? Because they're globalists.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what say does that star-spangled banner yet wave?
Look at them. They're women that love Trump. I'm telling you, women do like me. I'm telling you.
Oh, yeah, it is. I'll say that on air. Go ahead and make that point. Yeah, Tito Ortiz, yeah. Oh, you're live. Tell folks.
The bald guy right behind him, whose face you can see right now.
Behind Trump's.
Yeah, that's God former light heavyweight America. Champion, Tito Ortiz. He was one of the longest reigning champions in the UFC. It's crazy that he's there.
You know what's exciting? Because we actually have the raw footage. We're not just showing what we want. It's live feeds every day. And it's like half the people are Hispanic. Going in.
No, he's racist, though. No, that's not possible.
But I love how they tell Hispanics that are like almost half the country now. It's their country. They can't have red, white, and blue. They can't have private property. They can't have guns. They can't have Americana. They're supposed to be Bernie supporters. I mean, what are they going to do when he has a landslide of Hispanic voters?
he's going to have a landslide of Hispanic voters because he understands what makes this country great. And it is capitalism. It's hard work. And those are people that believe in hard work. You know, like if when I'm looking for to somebody to work with, and I was like, oh, this is a Mexican-American second generation immigrant. Cannot wait to work with you because that is going to be a hard worker guy.
You know, it is actually a cliche, but it's true that third, fourth generation white people and in certain sense black folks, but and of course that's a cliche. A lot of folks are hard workers, they're white. It is true that second generation Hispanics are some of the hardest working folks out there.
Unbelievable. They work so hard every chance they get. So they put me to shame sometimes.
And so they're responding to family and sovereignty and lower taxes.
So people, they're scared. They're scared of this idea that he's bringing back patriotism. You know, this globalism is the thing. It's the thing that they want everybody to love. And when you're proud to be an American, when you're proud to put up the American flag, when you're proud seeing the Star-Spangled Banner, that undermines everything they're trying to achieve. It undermines their authority.
Exactly. To be clear, I didn't edit that. That was the clip from Fox. They edited it down because I guess they didn't want to hear the whole Star-Spangled Banner or whoever edited that at Fox. And the rest of me didn't even want it to be seen. But exactly. And it's not that America's perfect. Sometimes they use our images for bad things. And when I see that happening, I say it. But overall, everybody wanted to come here because we were better. The idea was better. And that's why they're so scared of it. Go ahead, Tim.
The idea still is better. It was. Yes, it was better than, you know.
And it is.
It still is. And they don't want people to understand that. They don't want people to look back and remember, okay, this is what a tyrannical government looks like. This is what overtaxation looks like. This is what happens when you lose your freedoms. That's why we had a revolution. So they don't want us to look back. Looking back is being patriotic. It's recognizing what happened, what changed
our roots.
Our roots. And that now we are at a point where we have somebody that's saying, no, let's remember who we were. Let's make us great again. And being patriotic is a good thing to do.
Overall, I mean, obviously, a Hillary versus Trump campaign. He is the presumptive nominee now. He's clinched the delegates. Who are you supporting?
I hate Hillary so much, I would vote for anybody but her. You know, she should be in handcuffs. But, you know, between Hillary and Trump, I'm voting for Trump.
Sure. And I mean, obviously, you know, you still work at the Pentagon. You do a lot of secretive stuff. And they pressure troops to not be able to have their own views. But as a citizen, I mean, give us your real take on Trump, because I don't completely trust him either. In some cases, he's been too liberal for me, but the power structure is so scared of him. The Chinese communists, the Saudi Arabian government telling me I can't have him. I mean, they're scared of him because he's his own real guy. Why do you think they're so scared of him? And what are your issues with Trump?
You know, I'm a libertarian constitutionalist, so I believe in freedom. I don't care, you know, if my neighbor's gay with his beautiful husband and wants to smoke heroin, so they can raise their goat. That's going to be their kid because that's what they believe it identifies as. Awesome. Live your life. Do it. And let me go shoot my guns, have my barbecue, ride my motorcycle, and enjoy my beer. I'm worried sometimes that Trump, you know, he's a Republican now.
He's a little too authoritarian, I guess.
He is. You know, like, I want, like, just get out of my life, government. Let me live.
But we know Hillary's authoritarian, but I get you. I get you.
And, you know, it was just a few years ago where, you know, he's helping and supporting people in the Democratic Party. Now I'm saying, okay, obviously Reagan had a change of opinion. And
I agree. I'll tell you this, though. Trump knows now if he doesn't deliver, he will be anathema because he's in a special zeitgeist right now. He's tied into Americana. He better try to deliver or he won't be. I mean, his name will now be the new Benedict Arnold.
Yeah, 100%. He this is his chance. And if it goes away, his hotels are gone, his business, his corporation, he put all the chips on the table. He doubled down.
Well, I mean, he's told me, I'm not going to get into it because it's private stuff, but let me just tell you, he's either the best liar in the world or he has known this all along and actually suckered them and has been positioning himself to try to destroy the Republic. And the word is, this is real. And I've been told that by Secret Service people. I've been told that by high-level other folks. They say, no, Trump was a listener of yours 5 years ago. Trump knows about this. Trump, of course, he said on air.
Yeah.
He's only 40 years, so we'll see.
God will hope.
Look, they got his phone tapped, and they're scared for real. This isn't fake scared, in my view. What do you think?
He will destroy everything they've worked so hard for since Carter.
If he delivers.
If he delivers, it will erode and destroy.
If he delivers, I don't want to say he's the new George Washington because he didn't, you know, fight for 6 years against all the odds, but politically, he's the new George Washington.
Yeah, he will overthrow the power struggle and the creation of this state, this, you know, this global, we're going to hold everybody's hands, we're going to be tolerant. politically correct, whatever this new version, we're going to tax you. We're going to create toll roads, even though we already taxed you to create them. We're going to have income tax, sales tax. You know, like,
we're going to screw you over and call it liberal.
Yeah, it's gone. And that scares them to their core.
Absolutely. The truth is, if he just does fair trade deals that aren't one-sided and does things like passes a law so they cut the corporate tax, they bring the money back, that right there is like untying a boat from the dock, you know, where the engine's going, but you won't go. You untie the rope. I mean, it's not that hard to fix the country.
No, it's, we say it's not that hard. You know, if I was in that position, I wouldn't even know where to start.
Well, a lot of economists I talk to, the truth is under globalism, they've got managed economies. They want communism in China, a few other places, managed kind of slavery in India, and then they leverage out all the other. There's a global takeover going on. And you do a few things like cut taxes on poor people and middle class like Kennedy did. Tax receipts double the next year. I mean, they know you cut taxes, more money comes in. They want them high to control people.
It's I don't understand how people don't understand economics. This is pretty like. 1 + 1 = 2. And when you start deducting,
you cut people's taxes by half, they're going to buy a ton of stuff. The economy's going to roar.
This is fantastic.
People are going to invest. They're going to feel good.
And when you think that, okay, I'm going to bring the standard of living in India up, what's going to happen to America that's here? Like, there's only one way that can happen. There's only so much finite money. Like, ours will decrease.
Exactly. And that's the standard global line. And you're right. The truth is, the way they set it up, it doesn't even get real money to the Indians. In many cases, they get poorer, yeah, but their elite get richer.
And we, and everyone here gets poor.
Well, that's what Ross Perot famously said. He said, look, I play the clips. He goes, they're paid on average $42 in Canada, factory worker. We're paid on average about $25. Now, 2 years ago, they got rid of their tariffs, and they opened it up, and now they've dropped down to about $25. Within 2 years of us with Mexico, we're average paid about $2 an hour, factory worker. We're going to be down to about $10. It happened.
That was a pretty good impression as well.
But I mean, it's just, I mean, this guy made like $10 million on his own. He knows what he's talking about. Ross Perot said, I manufacture stuff. I'm going to have to move to Mexico. And pretty soon, even though we're 10 bucks an hour, they'll pay him $5 an hour now in Mexico. It went up some. You can't compete. Everything's going to Mexico. I mean, and is Mexico better off now, Tim?
They absolutely are.
Yeah. Other than the huge drug war that's going on. But yeah, some of the factory works, some of their elites are better off. Well, look, I'm here asking the questions. I don't want to get into too much inside baseball, but big UFC announcements are coming in the next month or so.
Yeah, we can't talk about it. So all we can say is I got something great coming.
I'm not going to talk about it. I'm just like, shh. Just don't tell anybody.
Dana White here?
No, Dana White will kick my butt.
I won't even tell you because...
Yeah. He hadn't told me. No, but let's just say this. A little bird was going to tell me, and I said, don't tell me. I'm a good boy.
Thank you.
Tim, if you don't know this, I'm somebody that keeps secrets really good. In this job. I mean, it's not like your job, but you know, you got to keep secrets. Absolutely. You kill.
Oh, go to jail. Well, no, that's not necessarily the case, because apparently you can have your own email server and then share circuits.
I'm glad you brought up Hillary. General Petraeus.
I didn't bring up, I was just talking about private email servers that.
But I mean, General Petraeus had like three pieces of paper that was his job in his desk, and he got indicted and had to plead guilty. But Hillary got caught lying with thousands of things. New foreign governments were on there. The word is she was putting it on there, letting it get stolen with plausible deniability. They would then put millions in her deal.
That's criminal. Why is that person doing this not in jail? Why has not Trump attacked her? I mean, it's black and white to me, okay? Like, you did something wrong. You broke policy and broke the law, and now you're running for president. How can you not say... this is wrong. You cannot do this. You have to.
Well, I'll say this. If someone, say, in Delta Force gave out information like Hillary does, they would get life in prison probably.
Yeah. Or have to fall on your own sword, just like, and then you're dead. No, we don't really kill ourselves. But yeah, I would be a court martial. I would go to jail and I would never see the light of day again, I don't think. Seriously. If I did what she did. With confidential documents. If I took something off of, if I took secret things and put them on a private server, I'm done.
Well, you know, when you're leaving a building, you're facing life in prison with it in your briefcase.
Yeah. The laws are very, very clear. The policies are very, very clear. They're black and white. There's no confusion. There's no, I don't know if I'm allowed to do this. You know exactly what you're allowed to do. And
well, in fairness to Trump, he has said, hey, Bill Clinton's been connected to rape. Hey, Vince Foster murder. He has talked about some of the email. But what he does is when they attack him, he triples down. And I agree with you. I think he ought to just great guns, annihilate her now. He already surged ahead of her in polls as soon as he took the gloves off. And I happen to know Roger Stone, you know, Stone doesn't like to brag, but just like quiet professionals don't. But, you know, he's been Trump is now in the Stone Zone to a great extent, and you're seeing the results. Roger Stone is super smart.
It's going to be, it's a long way to November, but if this trend continues, it's hopefully she'll be in jail and we'll have a...
Well, I tell you, I agree. I've been thinking she's too big to fail, but I've been sensing the establishment knows they don't want her in there. She'll screw that. You know, even the establishment's not one group is what I'm saying. And look at this. The inspector general comes out and says, yeah, she had thousands of secret things. She lied about it. Well, of course she lied about it. So what do we do? I mean, what happens if she doesn't get indicted?
Maybe over the course of the next few months, as the election continues to roll, these little bits of information that will continue to trickle out. You know, we'll get bits, tiny bits of information. I don't know why it's bit at a time. New emails are released, a little bit more. Just tell us the truth. Why is this a new concept that you can go?
Yeah, the Chinese government and the Russians all got to be on her server. It's all out there. Why don't we get to know?
Just tell us the truth. Why have we forgotten that the truth is the thing that always wins? So just let us, the people, decide what's right and wrong and give us the truth.
You know, it's on the emails. Every day they release more. It's like her not letting small companies drill in America, but stop making sure that people can drill in, say, Africa.
Yeah.
Just everything is about not letting us operate. Because that's how they get power. They go to foreign nationals and go, I'll shut down America. That'll boost your interest. Yeah. Oh, I hear her laughing. Is that Hillary?
She's laughing at us.
Including FBI officials looking into whether national security was compromised because... including FBI officials looking into whether national security was compromised because...
How can you laugh?
By the way, rewind that. She's worse than the Joker. I mean, that's worse than a Batman movie, the way she's acting, because she's just sitting there, that's real, laughing at him when he brings stuff up. Can we play that again?
You violated laws.
including FBI officials looking into whether national security was compromised because... including
the contempt
FBI
that you have
officials.
To have. For
well, Brian Williams lost his job because he was stolen glory, claimed he was in a helicopter that got shot down. She did the same thing, said they got shot up on the ground with sniper fire. Wasn't true.
When she was going to Kosovo.
Yeah.
What she said?
Yeah.
It's weird. I just landed in Kosovo last week into Pristina, beautiful place. I was greeted with a warm latte and a whole bunch of beautiful guys and girls that were like dancing and cheering. And that's Kosovo. So... Yeah, she's a liar.
Oh, it's on tape the time she landed, and it was kids giving her stuff. It was families, it was dancers.
It's
like
a beautiful
you said.
Place. But the fact that you could just say, like, oh, I was under sniper fire when I was there, but now I'm running for president? The truth is gone. The truth is irrelevant. All that matters.
Because she's got all these zombies that are going to vote for her just because she's a woman. In your gut, do you think Trump's going to win, or do you think she'll steal it?
I don't see a way that she can win. I don't understand.
She does have a sense of just about to fall.
She does. The only thing that scares me about her is she will say anything to anyone to gain their approval and ultimately their vote. She'll lie. She'll cheat. She'll steal. She'll do anything. She'll lie to the families of dead Americans that died in Benghazi so she can get your vote.
I'm going to skip this break because this is so important. This final segment here with Tim Kennedy. Tim, Benghazi, you know, I've had some of these guys on. And they're just such amazing people. And they're there going, no, we were on the phone. We were ordered by the CIA to stand down. And they said that came from the State Department. They deny there's even a stand down. Of course there was a stand down. I mean, that just shows how crazy they are.
Yeah.
Was Benghazi the straw that broke the camel's back?
I mean, there were so many straws up to that point, you know, but for me, when that's my community. Those are my brothers. Those are my brothers and sisters. Those are my friends on planes that were sitting there pleading, imploring and begging, send us. We are 20 minutes away. I can be there in 20 minutes and we can save everyone. Just send us. And they sat on planes on a runway that weren't allowed to take off. Those are my friends. Instead, people died. Americans died.
Let me ask you this without getting into too much force structure stuff, but it's pretty well known. There were multiple drones above. That's declassified. 13 hours total, eight hours or so, correct me if I'm wrong, of real stand down when they could have been there in an hour and a half. And so how many hundreds or thousands of people were in those ships, in the bases in Italy, or on the planes loaded who knew what went on? I mean, that's the thing. They for whatever reason, they wanted Stevens dead and those weapons transferred. And they did it over 13 hours, 8 hours of a firefight. I mean, how did they think that wouldn't... I mean, that's just naked in front of the entire military community. I mean, that was really a bad move.
Yeah. So we know what 10 guys did there. 10 guys pushed off hundreds, maybe almost 1,000 coordinated terrorists that had a plan about what to do. Now, if we had introduced 10, 20, 30 more guys, that we could have wiped out everyone from the country. Every single bad dude there would be dead. But instead, we're just trying to survive. Everyone would have died had it not been for those, the 10 special operation contractors that were there. And not 20 minutes away was a plane full of, packed with special forces guys that wanted to be there.
Does it make? What difference at this point does it make?
I mean, we're really going to be led by this little thug witch.
Yeah. What difference does it make? The truth.
Okay.
This makes a difference.
So I'd said an hour and a half because I'd been in the news from Italy, but I had been told by others that it was 20 to 30 minutes away. That probably means what? In country or how? I mean.
Yeah, in country and at the border.
Egypt?
We had an entire company of light infantry guys on a plane ready to be there.
But wow, what would they have done to those guys? I mean, if 10 guys stopped, low estimates 500, maybe 1,000, wave after wave, hundreds of dead bodies at the hospital. If 10 guys could stop or hold back for 8.5 hours, 500 guys conservatively, what would that whole group have done?
They could have wiped off the entire terrorist element from that country.
Because Benghazi was the main invasion point at that time.
Yeah, absolutely. You take the leash off of, you know, a group of guys like that, and you say, all those guys are bad, go get them. It's not like, oh, what do we do? No, we know exactly what to do. We bury them. And it would have been done in hours, if not days.
You know, what is the difference between, you know, let's say fighting even Cuban troops? I've talked to a lot of special ops guys that fought them, and fighting others. I mean, a lot of these Muslims are crazy fighters. They'll blow themselves up. But, and so you got to have courage to fight them. But is it wrong to say statistically, though, because you see numbers of 10 special ops guys taking out 500, say, Russian fighters?
No, that'd be a different.
So what's the difference? What is it? Just the
training. You know, they're lazy. They're complacent. They're not disciplined. They're extremist fanatics.
So the difference is I've seen you shoot. I mean, it's incredible where you can hit every bullseye, say 20 rounds in your handgun, and like 100 yards, you're shooting stuff that, you know, is 100 yards away. A handgun shouldn't be able to hit. That's the difference.
Yeah, but I train 6 days a week, thousands and thousands of rounds every single week, you know, tens of thousands of rounds every single week, thousands of rounds every single day. Like I'm up at dawn. I go to bed, you know,
You've already been shooting and training today.
Today?
Yeah.
I've already trained two times.
Yeah. Haven't even eaten, too. We got your lunch out there.
Yeah.
Anyways, I tell you, that's wild. So that's the difference with a bunch of guys that, I mean, you've seen when they have little kids executing people and stuff. And then raping people. And then why do you think, I'm not just demonizing the left, it's true. The left loves these jihadis and they think it's so great. They hate America that gives women all these freedoms. Is this just a cuckolding, a suicide thing, a death wish? We hate daddy. We hate prosperity. I mean, America's not perfect, but why do so many leftist women and others love jihad?
I have no idea. Like, this is a group of people that are like, oh, you're gay? I'm going to push you off this building to your death. You know, like they don't like them, but the extremists,
the jihadis, yeah.
They're like, oh, you're not of the right descent. We're going to kill you. Oh, you want to go to school? We're going to kill you. But then we have a huge group of our political organizations that are supporting these fanatics. Like if you believe in the American way of life, you have to understand that everybody in radical Islam wants you dead.
That's right. I'll say it right now. Any of these weirdo leftists that are allied with this, I mean, I'm just done. I mean, Obama's been backing radical jihadists all over the Middle East to kill all these people. And they say, I'm against the Middle East. No, I'm not against that. I want moderate countries. I want them to have women going to college.
Yeah. Driving? You want women to drive?
Yeah, I'm extremist.
Yeah.
Well, I went to Barton Creek Mall a few weeks ago, and I saw people in the full burqas all over the place. And I tell you, I got freaked out, man. I mean, you know, it's... Because these women are like slaves. They may not even know they're slaves with Stockholm syndrome, but they are.
Yeah, they're owned, they're beaten, they're destroyed. There isn't an element of their life that isn't controlled by the radical male in the family. It's a bad thing to see.
And the left is allied with them. Do you think that's just mental illness or what is it, Tim Kennedy?
I can't comprehend why anyone in their right, sane mind would look at a radical extremist and be like, ah, man, there's certain elements about their life that I appreciate and value. You know, there's something there. I cannot comprehend how you can make a connection between what they do and what we as Americans consider to be a value.
Tim Kennedy, we're going to be doing a lot of exciting stuff. We've already shot a bunch of stuff that's going to be rolling out in the next few weeks here. You are really a busy guy. You're on the cover. What is it? Muscle and Fitness coming out?
Muscle Performance Magazine comes out next month, I think.
And a bunch of other stuff. I know a whole bunch of stuff's coming out.
Movie comes out next month.
What's that movie?
It's called Range 15. I'm naked. It's pretty cool.
Is that like zombies or something?
Yeah, I fight Randy Couture in the end with no clothes on, which is fun.
So, yeah. Is Shane in that too?
No. Shane's in everything. Like, I was like, finally, I got something that he's not in.
Okay.
Shane was going to be a zombie in it, but he has too much muscle.
Yeah, that's right. He is too big. Hey, Shane's coming along a long way in just a few years training.
He's a monster. He beat me today.
No.
We did this horrific, horrible, demon-like exercise of metabolic conditioning, and he finished before I did. So
I would tell you, when you guys are in there in your short sleeve shirts, you look bigger. But it's all hard muscle. It's not like water stuff like Schwarzenegger, which I know is in good shape. But you guys are in incredible shape. It's amazing.
Thanks. We're trying. Yeah.
Well, it makes me feel pretty bad when you're jogging like 2 miles off the waist for an hour this morning. I tell you, Tim Kennedy has been our guest. Tim, the websites for folks that want to find out what you're up to, what you're doing.
Sheepdogresponse.com, Tim Kennedy MMA. Everything for me is Tim Kennedy MMA on social media. You can Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and that's all on there.
We're going to let you eat in 6 minutes, 10 seconds, but we're going to come back and do 5 minutes on Sheepdog Response, because that's something I need to take time out and do, because
I'm making you go.
Believe me, I used to be a good shot and good at everything. I am like a joke now.
They want you dead.
I've gotten really rusty, so I'm going to need to go to this. It make good video, too, seeing my ass get kicked. We'll be back. Stay with us. All right, final segment that David Knight's taking over with all the news and analysis. The Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock. I'll be back this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. Central. Briefly, you want to talk about the difference between Memorial Day and Veterans Day. Then you were also put a tweet out about the millennials and like the Triggly Puffs and these socially entitled little anti-free speech hate mongers. Cover the waterfront, Tim.
Oh, my gosh. Whatever this disease is right now, that you can go to college and graduate with a degree in feminism and that you think you're going to come into the workforce and be a productive member of society, but then you're going to complain that you can't get a really good job. So you're going to vote for Bernie Sanders and think that you're going to give it. Listen, I work like 18 hours a day so I can provide for my family. That's how it's supposed to work. I fall into bed tired. So stop being entitled little bitches and go to work. Stop wasting your time figuring out what oil you're going to put in your beard if you're wearing the right plaid shirt. Do work. Go to work. Work. Go. Scoot.
Man, that was beautifully said right there.
Just over it.
You just said it all. That is like 30 seconds on the social justice warrior, because you're right. They've set up college to give you degrees that don't work, knowing you'd be mad and go join the socialist takeover. This was a plan.
Yeah. And then they're going to charge you for education, and then you're going to get loans that's provided by the government that then you're going to be paying interest to the government for the rest of your life, but you can never get a job to pay these loans back. So now you're just in the pocket of the government with a degree that's useless that you can never do anything with anyways. So,
and this is Tim Kennedy's message to social justice warriors, but you don't want to kill the gays, the radical Muslims do, but they're good and you're bad.
Yeah, obviously. Yeah, I'm a bigot. I'm a racist. I don't know what the problem is with this. We'll get it together eventually.
Getting back into all the great things you're doing, because, it's the same way. Having 20 irons in the fire, being involved, studies show this makes you more alive, makes you have more energy. And I have energy, not as much as you. People go, man, you're weird. You care about things. Well, you're dead if you don't care. You look at these zombies walking around. I'm not a tough guy like you, but compared to these people I am, they're like soft zombies. I don't care what color they are. It's scary.
It is. Look at my hands right now. I'm looking at the calluses that, like, I'm sitting there underneath the desk. I'm like pulling calluses off of my hands because we were deadlifting yesterday. That was before we went and did yoga, and that's before we went and shot, and that's before I went and did jujitsu, and then I went and shot again. That was my day yesterday. It was about 16 hours of work.
And it's empowering, not enslaving.
Yeah, it's kind of...
So it's the animating contest of liberty. I tell you, I can't wait with some of the stuff we're going to do. A lot of it's not even macho stuff. It's how to get, organic farming, raw milk. You and Shane are going to be, I guess you're, helping us get back to the primal human.
It's not that.
Folks think of the primal human as dumb, though. That's smart, right?
It's freedom. We're getting back to what freedom is.
Back to freedom is primal.
Yeah, it's not government saying, no, you can't buy raw milk. I'd be like, go screw yourself. I'll buy whatever I want. I'm American. That's what being free means. I'm going to go shoot a gun. I'm going to go ride a motorcycle without a helmet on if I feel like it. It's not hurting anybody but me. This is my life. I'm going to do what I want. That is the idea behind what liberty means. It's not anybody else telling me what to do. So we
1 minute on what I said we do. I apologize. We talked so much about 70 seconds on other topics. Sheepdog Response, I need to do it, because I'll be honest. I used to be an incredible shot, and I've got where I'm just okay now and everything else. And I need to get into what does Sheepdog do in 60 seconds? Tim Kennedy, give us the website.
Sheepdog gives you the tools that will make you the hardest person somebody ever tries to kill. You know, like looking at you, Alex, there are tons, there's hundreds, if not thousands of groups that want you dead. They hate every word that comes out of your mouth, and they want to shut you up, whatever that takes. So they're going to look at the most accessible, vulnerable part of your life.
How do you be a hard target?
You have to change your life to become a hard target, and that's what Sheepdog is. We show you where you're weak. We show you where your deficiencies are. We show you for situational awareness, biometrics, atmospheric, shooting, hand-to-hand combat, self-defense. We give you kind of a baseline. We can't give you everything in a week. We put you on a course to hopefully change your
life. A roadmap.
We line it out. You got to follow this to change your life so that when somebody tries to kill you, it's going to be one hell of a fight.
And people think, oh my gosh, I don't want to be all paranoid. No, it's animating to be involved and aware of your environment. That's what humans are supposed to do.
Yeah. I watch people go into like a supermarket now. They're looking down at their grocery list. They have no idea what's even around them. Just pull your chin.
It's like folks walking out in front of buses or just...
All the time. It's like we've lost our minds. We're so attached to these little electronic
devices. Amazing. Tim Kennedy, it's great to be working with you.
Love you.
Very exciting.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. This fourth hour, I'm David Knight on this Friday, May 27th, 2016. We've got some amazing news here. And of course, it's interesting when we look at this video game where they're portraying Alex Jones as a transhuman terrorist. I just got this tweet from my son talking about what's going on in the Marvel Comics world, the Captain America Marvel Comics world, where they are portraying all of the people who are fighting for their rights against government oppression with, I think, and many of them have pointed out how it's illegal for the government to own this land. The people who have stood up to this process, who have tried to get the government to be accountable to the Constitution, are now villains, and they are now being linked by the Marvel Comics people with the Red Skull. That's right. This is Goodwin's Law being taken to comic book caricatures. But that's truly what it is. The guy who is the Nazi from Captain America, the Red Skull, is now buddies with the Bundys. That's the way they're doing it. But let's take a look first at this Alex Jones. We're gonna play you some excerpts in terms of the attacks that have been coming fast and furious against those people who are fighting what many have called the Sagebrush Revolution. We're going to play a couple of back and forth from the hit piece that the Washington Post put out on that group. So it's not just Marvel Comics, but it's also the Washington Post. But let's take a look at what's happening in the video game world. They're coming after Alex Jones, depicting him as a transhuman terrorist. Now, Alex Jones is not going to become a transhuman, okay? But they want to portray him, nevertheless, as a terrorist, just as Marvel Comics wants to portray patriots who are standing up for property rights they've had for century and a half, that are being driven off of the land, being shut down by the government. Now they're depicting Alex Jones as a terrorist in this video game trailer. Let's take a look at this this trailer here.
Our God-given rights to defend our will.
Yes, sir. Anti-augmentation sentiment.
Our limbs. Do you understand?
What is happening on this planet is a mass fear-mongering, and the mainstream media pushing this narrative.
The officer suffered severe facial
incident after incident. After
you need
incident.
To be afraid, because they are coming for you.
You will not be made slaves to corporations.
Okay. That's actually kind of funny parody in the sense that he's got like a Piers Morgan moment there. And this guy that you see yelling, we will not relinquish our limbs. Okay. He's got an artificial arm that he's doing it. So I guess that's he has a right to keep and bear artificial arms. That's what they're trying to put out there. Okay. Now, Mark Dice looked at this and he pointed out in this article by Don Salazar, you can see the entire clip. We're going to play another part of it. For the trailer for the game, you can see that at Infowars.com in Adon's article, Alex Jones depicted as a transhuman terrorist in a new video game. In that article, he quotes Mark Dice, who says, this new video game is both interesting and disturbing. It raises some serious questions about the coming transhumanist technology, but it also appears to depict Alex Jones from Infowars.com as a transhuman terrorist who's behind a series of truck bombings that are designed to attack humans who are trying to round up the Augs, those who have augmentations, and put them in a concentration camp because of their technology's malfunctioning causing them to be a danger to others. Let's play another clip. I've got two clips out of this trailer for the video game. Let's play the next clip.
What do they have planned for us? Why are they building concentration camps? What's going on out there?
Reports of multiple fatalities.
There's only one way to deal with these bloodthirsty fanatics.
A lot of people die.
Okay, so we're just paranoid. You know, we're saying that, hey, as they're shutting down all of our privacy, as they're putting their hands on us at the airports, as they're looking for other ways to invade our bodies with their mandatory vaccines, as we see the rise of what appears to be drills for martial law, but even more concerning, the rise of geospatial intelligence to track us everywhere we go to control our movements. So we're just being paranoid. And as representative of that, they have a guy who looks very much like Alex. I mean, they even have the same background behind his head here that we have in the main studio. And he's got, as I point out, his Pierce Morgan moment there where he's yelling, you know, almost said 1776 will commence again if you take our artificial limbs, right? But that's they didn't go there. But they parodied that. Now, of course, today we've got Obama as I think it was yesterday. Actually, it was today. He's in Hiroshima. He's calling for a world without nuclear weapons. And this is from The Hill. They quote him as saying, "Death fell from the sky and the world was changed when America bombed Hiroshima." Well, you know what? Death fell from the sky and the world was changed when Pearl Harbor was bombed, too. And the bottom line is, I understand that FDR wanted that to happen. I understand there was a stand down at the upper levels, and in that sense, it was a false flag. But the Japanese really did bomb Pearl Harbor, folks. They really did. They really killed a lot of people. They did horrible things to people during the war. They were the aggressors, and we were the ones who shut that down. And so what could Obama do as we come to this Memorial Day? We remember people who fought for our country to keep it free. What could he do to come after America on his last Memorial Day as president? Well, what better thing to do than to go to Hiroshima and to rewrite history completely devoid of context and just say, you know, we killed a lot of people here. I'm so sorry about that. Well, you know, the Japanese killed a lot of people and they started it. They started it. Yeah, we could have stopped them if FDR would have put up some defenses or whatever, but that was their choice. They decided that they wanted to attack America. And they needed to bear the consequences. And if we look at the consequences of what would have happened, would there have been more people who would have died if we would have taken it by conventional warfare? You know, when we had, who's the guy that was on The Fog of War? McNamara. He did a documentary with this master documentarian. He's able to get people to confess to murder as he did in The Thin Blue Line. And he talked to Robert McNamara about his involvement in World War II and then the fact that he pushed this domino theory in Vietnam and so forth. And McNamara said, we killed more people in the Dresden bombings. It was a worse catastrophe than what happened with the nuclear weapons. And he said, if we'd lost, we would have been tried as war criminals. He wouldn't confess to being a war criminal because of Vietnam. He did confess to the fact that the Gulf of Tonkin issue was a complete fabrication, that it was a lie, that it was a false flag to get us involved in that, and that he escalated that. But when we look at what would have happened, yeah, it would have been a catastrophe. It would have been a civilian catastrophe because they would have fought to the end, I believe, and there would have been a lot of American lives lost as well. And so it has to be put into that context. Yes, do we want to try to control nuclear weapons? Of course we want to try to control nuclear weapons. But Obama, when he says we want a world without nuclear weapons, he's just playing to the liberal crowd that's in la-la land. You know, you've squeezed that toothpaste out of the tube, unfortunately. And we can't go back to a world without nuclear weapons. We can have an America without nuclear weapons while the rest of the world has nuclear weapons, but we can't go back there. Here's the real issue. While he talks about that and portrays himself as being this compassionate individual, he's creating biological, chemical warfare weapons. We had pointed out on our show many times by people who are experts on this, Francis Boyle was a guest of mine earlier this week. When he was on with Alex Jones at the end of January, he said the bioweapons program that the Pentagon has is three times larger than the Manhattan Project was that gave us nuclear weapons. So that's what they're creating. And then he parades around with this phony compassion saying, we want a world without nuclear weapons. What a bunch of nonsense. There's nothing behind this except to rewrite America's role in history. And that's the way USA Today headlines it. They say, first take, Hiroshima and Obama's sense of history. Obama is trying to write his own chapter in world history as a president who redefined America's role in the world. Yes, he wants to make America the villain in every case. Our free economy is a villain. Our military, when they fought back against aggression, is a villain. Okay, that was a defensive war, folks. And, you know, we were not the aggressors. We were not the villains in that. It's absolutely amazing to see Barack Obama do this. And it truly is a deliberate thing that he's doing here on Memorial Day weekend to rub America's nose in the ground, to rub my parents' generation's nose into the ground because he hates this country. He's got a sense of history from his CIA family that raised him in Indonesia. That's where he went to school. Okay, he hates this country. He wants to rewrite history on Memorial Day and say we're the bad guys who did all of this. Now, at the same time, I want to tell you how the media has spun what Trump said yesterday. This is North Dakota. I started to say South Dakota. He went to Bismarck, North Dakota. And there he said that he will undo Obama's climate change agenda. Now, it's reported by Reuters as this being an appeal to the oil sector. In other words, he's pandering to a bunch of oil company executives. He was speaking to 7,700 people. Okay, now, the conference center there was a Williston Basin Petroleum Conference in Bismarck. Was it 7,700 oil company executives, as they said? Are there that many oil company executives? Maybe there are. I don't know. But the bottom line is that we don't need this climate change treaty that was done. This is not something that is just simply targeted at one industry. This is targeting our entire economy. This will shut down our economy if we allow them to do this. What he needs to do is not just shut down that climate change treaty. Donald Trump needs to take away the police powers of the EPA. And he needs to take away their legislative powers. That's truly what needs to be done. He understands that we need to have regulation that is not, as he points out, outdated, unnecessary, bad for workers, contrary to the national interest. He needs to scrap it and needs to be scrapped completely. That's what he said he'll do. We will still have regard for rational environmental concerns, but not the agenda to take down this country that Obama and the EPA. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to talk about what's happening with the demonization of patriots, both by Washington Post and by Marvel Comics. We've also got some articles about Tennessee passing a Gold Reserve Act where they'll have a gold depository within the state. Texas did that last year. Now we've got another state, Tennessee. Very interesting to see this happening. Also, the TPP will subject Canadian citizens' banking data to the U.S. Patriot Act. And this is something that has come up once before. Rand Paul pointed this out. He was called quirky by Obama for being concerned about American citizens' financial data being exposed to foreign governments, being exposed to everybody, essentially. You know, it's the Fourth Amendment. We have a right to privacy in our person, our place, our papers, that sort of thing. You know, those principles that are there. Yeah, this is electronic in most cases. That doesn't mean that the principles don't apply. But the Canadians need to understand this, too. Do they really want to get under the Patriot Act? You know, the banks are telling them, yeah, you need to do that. So we're going to talk about that in just a moment. Before we do, we'll remind you that we now have Super Male Vitality back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. Right now, get your bottles before it sells out. It's a good time to stock up. It's been gone for over a month. If you're having trouble getting some of this stuff, sign up for our auto ship. That can get you a 10% discount. Make sure that this stuff doesn't ever go out of stock. But if it's something that you want to try or you're not on auto ship, now is a good time to get Super Male Vitality. It's back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. We've also extended the sale on our Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, 20% off. This is this weekend only. So it's about to end, the 20% off sale on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. This is something you really need to have for your family's emergency supply, as well as a key nutraceutical that you need to have available for your own health. It's 99.99% pure iodine salt crystals from deep within the earth, lab-tested for purity. You can get it 20% off right now. Survival Shield X2 nascent iodine at InfoWarsLife.com. Let's take this story about the TPP first, because I also want to talk about what's going on within the Libertarian Party. And I keep hearing, as I see these debates with the Libertarian Party, there was one that I watched with John Stossel, and they asked them about free trade. Look, I understand that free trade in principle is a good idea, but can we talk about what these trade deals are in reality? Okay? These are not free trade. We had NAFTA. Ron Paul correctly pointed out, you don't need a 1,000-page trade agreement to have free trade. You just have free trade. So it's not about that. It's about managed trade. It's about crony capitalism. And it's going to be managed by people that you don't have any say-so. People who aren't elected officials, even. People who are offshore are going to control our economy if this goes through. But there's also massive privacy issues involved in these treaties. They're not simply, they're not even trade treaties. These are treaties that were signed secretly, negotiated by these multinational corporations because they are stakeholders. You aren't. You don't own anything in their eyes. And so they created this thing and then dumped it on our legislators and said, you know, run this thing through. And the legislators obediently, I think it was 96, the final vote, 96-4 in the Senate, they said, yeah, we're going to shut this down. We're not going to follow the procedure that's in the Constitution for ratifying a treaty. That's what the Trade Promotion Authority, which is passed, that's what it's all about. It's about saying, you know, there's this process in the Constitution. We have to have 2/3 of the people in the Senate ratify a treaty. We're going to say, forget about that. We're going to say there's just a simple majority in the Senate and a simple majority in the House. And we're not going to have a debate. And we're not going to have amendments. And we're not going to have filibusters. And we're not going to be able to keep this from coming to the floor. They did all of that with the TPA. And, of course, you had Ted Cruz vote for that before he voted against it finally. Rand Paul voted against it consistently. And now it is coming up, hopefully, and this is a key thing. You're going to find that even though Hillary Clinton says she now opposes it, she will vote for this if she becomes president. I think Bernie Sanders would vote against it simply because he doesn't like corporations. Donald Trump will vote against it because he thinks it's a bad deal, and it is. But it is far more than just an economic treaty. It also affects our freedoms on the Internet. And then this new thing here from the New American. TPP would subject Canadian citizens' banking data to the USA Patriot Act, a provision in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Trade Agreement to which Canada and the United States are parties, makes it quite likely, quote-unquote, that the private banking details of Canadian citizens could be accessible to the American security intelligence agencies, according to a member of the Canadian Parliament. Now, one of these guys said there is a quid pro quo because a number of Canadian companies in the financial sectors, that's the banks, and the insurance sector have told us that the cross-border flow of data is very important. So there you go. If the bankers tell you it's important to them, it doesn't matter about our privacy. And it doesn't matter about the Bill of Rights or the Constitution either, because the bankers want it. Just do whatever they say. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to talk about what's going on in the Libertarian Party as well as with these attacks on patriots. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this fourth hour. You know, we see this back and forth going on between Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders. Perhaps they're going to do a debate. Very interesting idea. It shows how things are really being shaken up, but also the people who have been there as the core of the establishment parties and the Democrat and Republican parties are closing the ranks. And they are coming out and telling people they need to back off on some of this third-party insurrection here. Just as we saw the Republican Party come out against Donald Trump, we now have the party faithful coming out against Bernie Sanders within the Democrat Party. This is the Daily Cause. The guy that they took his, it's named after him. His name is Mark Cause Malutsis, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Sorry if I'm butchering your name here, but he's the founder and editor-in-chief of the Daily Cause, a liberal blogging site, supports the Democrat Party. This is an article from Mint Press. He told the site's users in March that the site would soon be transitioning to, quote-unquote, general election footing. So here's this guy, what is he, 20-something or whatever, you know, like a Zuckerberg. These guys want to be your little political dictators. They're going to control the press. These guys have the most contempt for free speech I've ever seen in my life. Of course, that's what they've been raised on in these schools. Shut down, as we've been talking about all day. Shut down anybody who opposes your viewpoint. Absolute total censorship. Absolute total intolerance. And often that's what they excuse it with. Tolerance. In the name of tolerance, we're going to shut down your free speech. We're going to censor you. We're going to say that you need to be killed. So here he is. He says, we're going to go pretty soon on the Daily Cause. We're going to go to general election footing. Well, what does that mean? Well, the Mint Press says this, according to his blog post, that this meant that bloggers would be banned from making, quote, attacks on Hillary Clinton using right-wing tropes or sources. So no criticism of Hillary Clinton on the Daily Cause. Now, he goes on to say, you can talk about Bernie, just don't use any talking points from the right wing or any sources that we would consider to be right wing. or we're going to ban you. We're going to throw you off. Don't use terms like oligarch or warmonger, you know, that right wing stuff. You know, only right wingers can be warmongers. You can't call Hillary Clinton a warmonger. Users are also banned from advocating for third party Green candidate Jill Stein. Or any other third-party candidates. See, total censorship by the Daily Cause, okay? Founded in 2002. Doesn't take these little brats very long to try to trash free speech. Once they get a little bit of power, they have nothing but contempt for it. Now, what's going on with third parties? We've got, as we pointed out yesterday, we had an interview with John McAfee, and we pointed out then that the Libertarians are meeting in a convention in Orlando this weekend. They will pick their nominee at convention this weekend. Last night, they began with a debate. And during that debate, Gary Johnson, who appears to be the darling of the establishment press, because why? He's an established politician, and they just want an established politician so badly, especially the Never Trump people. So they want an establishment politician like Gary Johnson. And he was asked by Austin Peterson, who is also running, said, this is according to Reason Magazine, Peterson, who's been making hay with the contention that, quote, it's time for us to stop nominating failed Republicans. I don't know if Gary Johnson, I would even consider him to be a Republican. I think he's a Democrat. He won twice in a Democrat state. Second time he won with an even larger margin because he did exactly what a Democrat would have done in that case. He wisely positioned himself and labeled himself as a Republican so the Republicans wouldn't oppose him. But he governed as a Democrat, and so did the guy that he is holding up, William Weld, who was a two-term governor from Massachusetts. He also governed as a Democrat. But Peterson says it's time to stop nominating failed Republicans and start nominating successful Libertarians. And he got sustained applause when he challenged Johnson over saying that he wants to have William Weld, the two-term liberal government governor from Massachusetts, as his vice president to run running mate. He said in 2012, William Weld didn't endorse Ron Paul. He didn't endorse you. He endorsed Mitt Romney. And in 2016, William Weld, before he decided that he wanted to be a libertarian, endorsed John Kasich. He says, why didn't your VP pick you? And Johnson came back, they said, with a rambling answer, and you can see the video if you go to Reason. He started off by saying that Weld was beyond his wildest dreams to be able to have an establishment politician. See, that's what's important to him. It's not about individual liberty. It's about saying, we've got a ticket with two establishment Republicans. Look, the Libertarian Party, and I hate to see this, the Libertarian Party this weekend is in a fight for its very soul. Whether or not it's going to mean anything or whether or not they're going to sell out for the admiration of the K Street, Wall Street lobbyist juncture, okay? That's what they want. They don't care about Main Street. They want Wall Street and K Street lobbyists to admire them. And then he went on to say this, and this is what got him booed. Gary Johnson said William Weld was, quote, the original libertarian. Okay, well, let's talk a little bit about William Weld here. It's truly amazing. As the interview yesterday, John McAfee pointed out, I haven't met a single libertarian that doesn't believe we have a right to own and keep arms. And Gary Johnson picks a man who doesn't want anyone under 21 having a gun, who doesn't believe that arms are necessary unless they're used for hunting. You can see this on the article and video that we've got of the interview. McAfee says Republicans are taking over the Libertarian Party. Yes, they are. Yes, they are. They're pandering. They want to be looked at as an established party. They have seen a massive increase in people who are interested in what they're about. because they don't like Trump or they don't like Hillary or Bernie, and so people are checking them out. And so what they decide that they will do is try to present themselves as the GOP establishment. I think it's really sad. You know, they have put themselves out there for the longest time and said, when people say, what is the Libertarian Party about? And they've done this for longer than I was involved there. They used to tell people, well, we're fiscally conservative, but we're socially liberal. And I never really liked that. I think they ought to just say, we're for individual liberty, because that's what they should be for. See, when they say they're for fiscally conservative, they're telling people, you know, when it comes to money, we're like the GOP. And when it comes to social policy, we're like the Democrats. And boy, Gary Johnson truly is like the Democrats. When he ran last time, he was all about abortion, about gay marriage. And those are not issues. When I was in the Libertarian Party, of course, gay marriage was not on the radar at that point. But certainly abortion was. And there was a pro-life movement within the Libertarian Party. When I was there, I really wasn't part of it until I ran for Congress. And then as people started asking me questions about it, I started thinking about it deeply. It wasn't anything I'd ever really thought about in my personal life. And at that time, partial birth abortion was beginning. And once I looked at that, because people asked me, well, would you support partial birth abortion? And I looked at it, and it's like, wow. When I looked at the procedure, I said, this is just murdering a baby. This is murdering a full-term baby. No, I'm not for that. And that was the beginning of my change. Actually, running for office changed me. So, yeah, people can change their positions on things. I'm not really so sure that William Weld has come around. He supported an assault weapons ban. You know, he comes back and he tells the people at the Libertarian Party, he says, well, I'm a lifelong hunter and gun owner. As a governor of Massachusetts, I went along with some modest restrictions on certain types of firearms. Other people would call that an assault weapon ban. Okay, but he calls it modest restrictions on certain types of firearms, okay? Talk about a politician. Talk about throwing this stuff around. I mean, it is flying fast and furious from these guys. He says, I was deeply concerned about gun violence, and frankly, the people I represented were demanding action. So there you go. If the mob wants to take your gun, William Wells said, hey, I'm with the mob. I don't really care about your God-given rights. I don't really care about the Constitution that prohibits that. Yeah, the majority of people want to take it. See, that's the living document view of the Constitution. We don't really care what it says. It's just words. And we don't really want to be caught up with words that much. We're going to just go with what we think it should be. And he says, sometimes governing involves tough choices. I had to make more than a few of those. Today, 25 years later, I would make some different choices. Notice he doesn't say that he is just unqualified support for individual liberty. That's the problem. And that's the choice that is being faced by the libertarians this weekend. Are they going to lose the fight for individual liberty? You know, when he talks about being socially liberal and fiscally conservative, understand that the Republicans are not fiscally conservative. They are engineering the economy. And the Democrats are not socially tolerant. They're very intolerant. They want to engineer the economy just as the Republicans want to, with crony capitalism, engineer the economy for their benefit. The Democrats want to engineer our bathrooms even, okay, down to that level. They want to engineer everything so that they are in control. We need to not play into that. We need to not say, well, I'm Republican on this issue and Democrat on that issue. We need to just say we're about individual liberty. That's what the founder said. Just say, I'm about liberty, and I will take liberty before safety. I will take liberty before prosperity. Give me liberty or give me death. And I don't really care about your pragmatic arguments about safety or prosperity. I want freedom, because if I give up my liberty to get any of that that you're promising me, I will never be, as a slave, prosperous. I will never, as a slave, be safe. So I don't really care about those arguments. Liberty comes first, second, third, last, always, okay? Now, let's talk about how, and we haven't covered this in detail. We mentioned it at the beginning of the week because this came out over the weekend. Washington Post singling out one individual in Oregon, B.J. Soper. This was featured on the Drudge Report for quite a while. Primed to fight the government, a fast-growing U.S. movement aimed with guns and the Constitution. How horrible is that? You're armed with guns and the Constitution. Sounds like a bunch of bitter clingers, doesn't it? Sees a dire threat to liberty. You bet. You bet. We see a dire threat to everything in this country. We see a dire threat to property rights everywhere when the government can come in and confiscate property rights that loggers, miners, ranchers have had, water rights, surface rights, mining rights, logging rights, to shut down the economy in the rural areas, that they would violate property rights and deeds that have been in force for over a century and a half. That they would come in with a pen and just declare that they are going to take over millions of acres in state after state after state, which is what Obama is doing. Now, I wanted to play for you. I'm not going to go over this whole article. It's a very long article. You should look at it. And, of course, they come after them trying to make him look dangerous because he's got his family there as they're training with firearms. And quite frankly, folks, that is not a dangerous thing. If you're going to have firearms, you need to have your kids. There he is. Isn't that awful? He's got a 16-year-old who is shooting a rifle, and he's got a young child, their four-year-old, watching the destructive power of a rifle so she doesn't play with it. That's what you want to do with your kids. You want to be able to defend yourselves, and you want to make sure that kids don't think that this is a toy, because in Hollywood, they like to show very reckless uses of guns. So it's a good thing as a parent for you to show responsible uses of guns. But anyway, they try to demonize him in another number of ways. They say he believes in Agenda 21 and a lot of things that they just dismiss as conspiracy theories. Yeah, they call it the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development now. It's still a UN agenda. They have rebranded it, and that's what they're talking about. So whenever they talk about sustainability, folks are talking about what we've been talking. Those of us who've been looking at it for a long time still call it Agenda 21 because that, quite frankly, is what it is. But one of the things that I wanted to focus on here is the back and forth between, they have a video embedded in the article where they actually let the man, BJ Soper, talk. And then they have a rebuttal from a law professor. So I want to play both of those, and I'm going to talk a little bit over them. Let's play that first one from BJ Soper, where he talks about the constitutional issues as if it mattered. Let's play that.
Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 17. To exercise exclusive legislation in all cases whatsoever over such district not exceeding 10 square miles as may, by cession of a particular state and the acceptance of Congress to become the seat of the government of the United States. Obviously, they're talking about Washington, D.C. here. So it continues on as, and to exercise like authority over all places purchased by the consent of the legislature of the state in which the same shall be for the erection of forts, magazines, arsenals, dockyards, and other needful buildings. So how I interpret this is that in order for the federal government to manage public lands or to own public lands, as it may be, they need to do three things. They need to get the consent of the legislature of the state that the land resides in. They need to pay for it. And they also need to use it for these specific purchases to erect forts, magazines, arsenals, dockyards, and other needful buildings. It's very clear that that is the limit of the federal government's ownership of lands within the
state. Absolutely. He lays it out precisely. He reads it for them, and he says, and of course, now this is what it means. You know, it means that we're talking 10 square miles. It's Washington, D.C. They need to get the permission from the state's legislatures if they're going to take this land. They need to pay for the land that they take, and they need to use it for these stated purposes, like creating forts or ports or those sorts of things. So then the Washington Post goes to this law professor. His name is Louis Steidman, and this is what he has to say.
His reading of the words is not the only possible reading, maybe not even the most natural reading. Beyond that, you know, there are complicated issues about federal land management.
Hold it right there. Hold it right there. Okay. His reading of the words is not the only possible meaning of the words. See, this is the way that they like to deconstruct things. Okay. It's the postmodern arguments here where they come in and say, you know, the words don't really mean what you think. 10 square miles, that could mean anything. Forts, ports, that could mean anything. Paying for the land, that doesn't really mean anything. This law professor is putting out the idea that is being sold by the Supreme Court and most of the people in the universities now. There was an article on Drudge Today, and I forget what the percentage was, but it was in the high 80s I think, or maybe it was 82%, if I remember correctly now. 82%, I think, of all the law professors, or was it lawyers, are Democrats. But the bottom line is, this is what they're teaching in the law schools. They're teaching words don't really mean anything. If words don't mean anything, then we can't have a discussion, can we? If everything is just subjective and it's whatever I say it means, then what are we even talking about? But then he goes on to try to make an argument. So first he tries to muddy the water by saying, well, you know, that's just words. I'm not going to debate those words. I'm not going to say, well, okay, what he's talking about there in the Constitution, this is the way that I understand. He's not going to even interpret it. He just doesn't care. He says, well, you know, we could look at other things. Let's continue on with what he has to say with this.
To be debated and thought about.
But he's not going to debate it.
Obvious the federal government should own as much land as it does currently. But if you want a really bizarre way of settling that dispute, it would be trying to figure out what words written 250 years ago by people who are no longer alive.
Oh, we just can't know. We just can't know. Stay with us. We're going to keep on with this. We're going to tell you what Marvel Comics says. It's impossible to know what words like forts and ports meant because they were written 200 years ago. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. In our final segment, I'm David Knight. Before we go back to this law professor saying that we can't possibly understand the words of the Constitution, I want to remind you that we've extended the sale for Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, 20% off. We've extended that sale through this weekend only, and then it will be ending. We've had that on sale for, I think, probably about a week. We do have Super Male Vitality back in stock. It has been out for over a month. It is now back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com, so check those out. Again, 20% off InfoWars Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. That's our 99.99% pure iodine salt. Crystals come from deep within the earth. It's in a very easy form to take. It's in liquid form. So you don't have to swallow pills or do anything like that. I love having these liquid supplements that are great quality like that. Get it for 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, again, this is from the article that was put out this last weekend by the Washington Post. They talked to a guy, B.J. Soper. He was very concerned about the direction our country was headed. He saw what the government is doing in terms of stealing land, in terms of tearing up treaties with people that they made. That's what these property rights are. You know, they're not saying that they own the land. This is the way it's being spun by the urban media. The same person can have mining. You can have multiple people on the same piece of land, can have water rights, surface rights, or mining rights, okay, on the same piece of land. Three people could have property rights, and those are just different forms of property rights, even logging rights. All of those could be on the same piece of land. Somebody could be taking out the dead wood, making the place safer so you don't have uncontrolled fires. At the same time, someone else is mining below it. At the same time, somebody else is grazing cattle on it. You can have multiple uses of this for that benefit everybody. But the government would rather burn the economy down in the rural areas. And you got Obama with his pen taking millions of acres of land. And so the response from this guy, when he sees what happened with the Bundy Ranch, when he sees what's happening in Oregon, his response is to create an educational group, Central Oregon Constitutional Guard. They tried to make him look like a demon by talking to the Southern Poverty Law Center, the people who actually, these people, before he founded the Southern Poverty Law Center, the founder defended the Ku Klux Klan during the Civil Rights era. That was the only thing that he got involved in, and they had the audacity to call it the Southern Poverty Law Center. He never worked for civil rights. He simply defended the Ku Klux Klan. And so this is a guy who was out there trying to make everybody look dangerous. But they show that he is going out educating people, and we had this back and forth. First, he has a video where he talks about his understanding of the Constitution. Then this law professor comes in. I want to pick this up. He's telling everybody that you can't possibly understand what's in the Constitution. Listen to this.
It would be trying to figure out what words written 250 years ago by people who are no longer alive and who had some very odd ideas about things.
He doesn't like their ideas.
Would you say that the sweeping clause would be something that would, in some way, give the government the power to own large tracts of land?
The sweeping clause.
Well, as usual.
Okay. All right. Let's hold it right there. Look, they've got all these clauses. They've got the Commerce Clause. They've got the sweeping clause. They've got supremacy clauses. All these are the Commerce Clause. They use all these different arguments. Well, you know what? Every time they do that, You have to point out to them that the Ninth and Tenth Amendment superseded any of those things, even if that was the correct interpretation of it, and it's not. Okay, the Commerce Clause would say we're going to have free trade with the United States, and yet you've got the government saying you can't have competition across state lines with insurance companies. They shut down that trade. But then they use the Commerce Clause to say, but no, we can regulate all the rest of your economic activity. It's a total fraud. The Ninth and Tenth Amendment superseded that. That's what he was saying. That's the lies that they feed you. And I didn't have time to go into what Marvel Comics is doing. They got the Red Skull out there making common cause with these poor people that the government is attacking out there, showing them as the victims. This is Goodwin's Law, because this is the guy who represents Hitler in a very obvious way, saying he's got common cause with these cowboys out there. Join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for the Nightly News.